Muhammad Adil Salam, and the topic is India in Contemporary Arabic Literature. मैंने दरअसल सोचा था कि आज का कार्यक्रम हम लाइव करेंगे, लेकिन I think people are not yet ready for it. Am I right? Maybe next time. Maybe. In fact, even Mr. Amit Kashyap said he would come in person, but wo ho nahi paya in the end. Anyhow, we look forward to meeting, you know, face to face with adequate social distancing as well as other precautions. तो चलिए इसको हम शुरू करते हैं. मुझे एक दो चीजें सिर्फ कहनी थी शुरुआत में. एक तो के पहला आदिल साहब का प्रेजेंटेशन हो चुका है, मैं राइट? ये दूसरा वाला है, मैं राइट हूँ?
ये इंट्रोडक्टरी हो चुका है ये.
हाँ जी, हाँ जी, एग्जैक्टली. तो मुझे दरअसल सिर्फ वन और टू मेरे ऑब्जर्वेशंस थे आदिल जी. एंड एक तो ये जो एब्स्ट्रैक्ट है, इसमें भी जो पहले से आप जिस तरह से सर्वे कर रहे हैं, वो अभी भी वही लग रहा है कि इंडस वैली से लेके अभी तक, यू नो, कंटेम्प्रेरी पे आई सपोज लास्ट पैराग्राफ ही है. तो एक मेरी चिंता ये थी कि हम जो पिछड़ी बातें हैं उसी में ज़्यादा उलझ जाएंगे. यानी इफ़ यू सी द प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ योर वर्क, दिस इज़ जस्ट समथिंग फॉर यू टू कंसिडर. That the prehistory, etc., the earlier contacts, and it's a very rich history, because I think within about 20-30 years of the Prophet's passing, you know, the armies were already on the outskirts of Makrana and Sindh. So wo bhi contact itna gehra aur lamba hai that I think that you know, in terms of usko sametna ho, you know, in the interests of compactness, the contemporary period is what I think you should be concentrating. That was my first suggestion. And the second thing, I remember raising it earlier, but I feel many times, especially with younger scholars, that you know, we have to distinguish between a survey and a problematic. So kya hota hai ki hamare yahan research jisko hum kehte hain, it is more or less like a survey. कि किसी चीज़ को हम आउटलाइन करते हैं, फिर यू नो, वी एक्सपैंड ऑन द डिफरेंट लिंक्स दैट आर कंटेन्ड दैट. बट मुझे लग रहा है कि ह्यूमैनिटीज़ एंड सोशल स्टडीज़ में जब हमें नए विचार लाने हैं, कुछ नई हमें सोच या शोध या कुछ परिवर्तित जो हमें कर सके वैचारिक दुनिया में हमारे, वो करना हो तो हमें एक प्रॉब्लमैटिक चाहिए कि हम किस चीज़ को सुलझाना चाहते हैं, किस गुंथी को हम सुलझाना चाहते हैं, यू नो. फॉर एग्जांपल, अब देखिए ना, इन योर ओन टॉपिक यू कैन सी, यू नो, यू कैन, आई एम नॉट सेइंग यू शुड और आई कैन सी इट एंड यू कांट एंड वाइस वर्सा. मैं सिर्फ ये कहना चाह रहा हूँ कि वन कैन सी कॉन्ट्रास्टिंग कंटेम्प्रेरी एटीट्यूड्स टू इंडिया. वन कुड फॉर एग्जाम्पल, मैं पिछले कई दिनों से ये पढ़ रहा था, एंड आपने भी इसका जिक्र किया कि यूएई हैज नॉर्मलाइज्ड इट्स रिलेशंस विद इज़राइल. एंड आज ही मैं पढ़ रहा था गल्फ पेपर्स में, मैं कभी कभी पढ़ता हूँ, थोड़ा लिखता भी हूँ गल्फ पेपर्स के लिए, इसलिए कुछ अंदाज़ा मुझे लेना ज़रूरी लगता है कि क्या हो रहा है उस दुनिया में. तो मुझे ये लग रहा है कि अब देखिए, सऊदी अरब जो इट्स अ वेरी वेरी पावरफुल एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट कंट्री, और उनमें और ईरान में जो जिस तरह का टेंशन है, वो इंडिया के एटीट्यूड जो उनके हैं वहाँ भी रिफ्लेक्ट कर रहा है. जैसे व्हाट आई एम रीडिंग, आई मे बी कम्प्लीटली रॉन्ग, दैट देयर इज अ शिफ्ट फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान टुवर्ड्स इंडिया, यू नो, इन सऊदी अरेबिया एंड द गल्फ, एंड गल्फ में बीच में भी अपने कतर और दुबई, इस तरह से उनके अपने चीज़ें होती हैं. सो ऑल आई एम ट्राइंग टू से, दिस इज़ अ वेरी कंटेम्प्रेरी एग्जाम्पल विच हैज़ नथिंग टू डू विथ योर रिसर्च. आई एम जस्ट गिविंग इट by way of an illustration, कि ये जो attitudes to India है, these are not homogeneous. These are diverse, varied, they can be periodized, मतलब they can be mounted on some sort of maybe evolutionary scale or map, but certainly in the diversity of these attitudes, there will be internal tensions and contradictions. तो उसमें से एक प्रॉब्लमैटिक उभर सकती है. क्योंकि मुझे तो लिटरेचर इतना मालूम नहीं है. माई ओनली अक्वेंटेंसेज, बिकॉज आई एम फ्रेंड्स विद सम राइटर्स, आई न्यू मोहम्मद दरवीश जी, एज आई टोल्ड यू. बनीपाल एक मैगजीन है, उसके एडिटर सैम्यूअल शिमॉन है, ही इज ओरिजिनली फ्रॉम इराक, ही इज अ फ्रेंड ऑफ माइंड. सम ऑफ द टॉप अरबिक राइटर्स आर पब्लिश्ड इन दैट एंड आई हैव मेट हिम सेवरल टाइम्स. तो मेरा अक्वेंटेंस इस तरह से है. आई नो सम राइटर्स हु हैव सेटल्ड इन बेल्जियम, फ्रांस, अरबिक राइटर्स. Many have come out of Iraq and the kinds of problems they have faced there because those countries and Syria. So, I mean, I'm not an expert like you, but all I'm trying to say is, agar aap ek problematic ko isme se ubhar ke agar aapko mehsoos ho aur uska aap vishleshan karenge, to it will be more, I would say, a contribution to knowledge, and it would be much more rigorous and challenging, stimulating intellectually than a survey. यही मेरा आपको सुझाव है, because you've already done a lot of work. So अब ये जो stage आपकी जो research की है, इसमें you should look for that problematic and organize your work, you know, so that that problematic is discussed and analyzed and debated and your own proposition, इसमें एक proposition, आपका एक प्रस्ताव निकल आ सकता है. So these are my preliminary suggestions. I wish you all the best. We are very proud of you and your work. It's a unique work. I hope you know that a very good book will come out of this. With these words, I will hand it over to Hitendra ji, and I will also unmute my own. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for beginning with right note, because this is what we had been discussing, and I was also suggesting that that part is going to be more important and more engaging. But you know, we all are so ignorant about what has happened in that part of the globe that a scholar like Muhammad Adil Salam will have to bring in a lot of information which may be of general in nature, but he will try to make a kind of presentation in which we will be introduced to it and then move towards a problematic, as you have rightly pointed out, because that is the way a scholar should move, from survey to some kind of a problematic, and somehow get kind of one kind of association. We all know, friends, that Dr. Muhammad Adil Salam is a scholar who is well versed with Arabic literature, modern Arabic literature, and he has worked. He has done his PhD from the English and Foreign Languages University, Hyderabad. His PhD was on response of Egyptian writers to the writings of Orientalists, a case study on Mahmud Shakir. So he has now come here, luckily, to work on India in contemporary Arabic literature. And from the abstract, what we can make out is that he's basically dealing with idea of India in contemporary Arabic literature. And we look forward to his presentation and hope that the modern part will get more attention so that we can have an engagement around which he can develop his work further. This is his first presentation after that introductory presentation. And he's a very promising scholar, and he's giving us a lot of insights and some kind of understanding, because you know, we all are, as I've already said, that we know more about the Western world than our neighbors, and in a way Arabic world has so much in common with our own world that when he brings those even facts, how we were related from ancient days to, I mean, earlier days to 2000, his entire historical association and all that, we get sometimes amused why we know so little about that region. So he is bringing literary perspectives into this discussion, and let us see what Arab world thinks about Kashmir and even Babri Masjid. That is what it is get mentioned. So over to Adil for your presentation.
थैंक यू डायरेक्टर सर प्रांशु जी, थैंक यू हितेंद्र जी। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल डायरेक्टर हैज राइटली पॉइंटेड आउट दैट दिस द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ माय रिसर्च वर्क इज जनरल इन नेचर। इट्स ट्रू दैट दिस जनरल इन नेचर, बट व्हाट आई वांटेड टू डू इज टू आई वांट टू मेक द कनेक्शन बिटवीन व्हाट हैड हैपेंड इन इस्लामिक पीरियड और प्री इस्लामिक पीरियड एंड व्हाट इज हैपनिंग नाउ। So that's why I was forced to do some kind of general work in order to make a connect in subsequent chapter, like in third, second, third, and fourth chapter. So that's first thing. And the presentation I want to make here is divided into two parts. The first part is general one that like director sir has said, and this in the first part I will be discussing in Indo-Arab relations. And then after I'll be dealing with the Islamic literature, so-called Islamic literature. I will explain what is Islamic literature and what did I mean while writing it. And the third part of it will be dealing the understanding of medieval historians of Arabic, medieval historians of Arab and geographers and so on from Arab. So their understanding about India, Indian caste system, Indian religion, Indian tradition and all. So that's the first part. And the second part, the where I begin my work will be on contemporary Arabic poetry on India. So that will be the more interesting part on which I am dealing with. So within the first part, I mean, I suppose everybody knows about this Indo-Arab relations, not in the terms of modern system, in terms of pre-historic era, pre-Islamic era. So just I want to make a couple of things clear. Like when we talk about the Indo-Arab relationship in pre-Islamic area, it becomes Indo-West Asian relation, because Arabic nation was not that prominent at that time. Arab as a nation comes out after the advent of Islam, predominantly in 8th century. Before 8th century, we cannot say it's an Indo-Arab relation. It's Indo-West Asian relation. And the second thing is like, when we talk about this West Asian and Indus connection, so the main connection between India and the West, so that part of India is not currently in India. That's the Sindh, Balochistan, and other part of the Indus Valley part of India. So that's one thing. And the second thing is that the periodization that I have made in my chapter is according to Arab periodization, like pre-Islamic and then Islamic. In Islamic, there is caliphate system, the first caliphate, second, third, and fourth. And then after I talked about this Umayyad and Abbasi and post-Abbasi period and then independence. So that's a pure Arabic periodization, because I am seeing India from their perspectives. So I had to come with this perspective. So these are the things that I want to make it clear. And the third thing is, when we talk about the Indo-West Asian relationship, mostly they have talked about the Indus Valley civilization's connection with this Mesopotamian and Babylonia and Egypt. And until I think 1980s, in the 80s, they did not make any connection with the neighbor Arabs, like what we call Oman and the Yemen and this UAE, some part of UAE and the Bahrain. And previously, which was known as Magan and Dilmun and some other name, with some other names. So recent equation had made the clear that they had relationship with India, in like they had relationship with this Babylonia and Mesopotamia and Egypt. So that's other part. I'm skipping the part of this prehistoric era, because I reckon most of us know about this. I'm starting with my Islamic period with the prophet. And that's where the Indo-Arab relationship comes into the picture in real sense. So with this caliphate system, we are well aware of that there was prophet and he had caliphate successively, Abu Bakr, Umar and Usman and Ali. So I will be dealing with in this chapter with this their relationship with India, how they knew about India, what kind of connection they had with India and Indians, and so on. So I'm starting with this. With the advent of Islam, a new chapter in the history of Indo-Arab context starts. It's fair to say that the tradition of exchange in the sphere of trade, social and cultures were established by the time Prophet Muhammad has embarked on his mission of spreading Islam. Three Indian origin word found in Quran, Miss Zanjabil, and Miss Kafur. Many Indian words have found in ways in Arabic dictionary. This shows that trade with India was not confined to the exchange of commodities, but it's also in this Arabic vocabulary. According to one prophetic tradition, which is Hadith, I'll explain it later. Prophet Muhammad is said to have received a jar of ginger pickle from an Indian Raja, which he tested and shared with his companions. Commercial contacts with Arab led to some Indian settlement in Arabian Peninsula. This is a fact very few of us know about it, that Indian settlement had occurred in Arabian Peninsula, including Iraq and this in Babylonia and this Iranian-Iraqian border. This is Basra and suburb area. They were known to Arab and Prophet Muhammad, as evident in one case where Prophet happened to meet a delegates who came to talk to him regarding Islam. Seeing them coming from distant, he remarked, "Who are these people who resemble men of India?" Prophet is also reported to have compared Moses with Jat, an Indian tribe. Jat is very famous. So Jat have very long tradition with Arabian system. I will explain it later in terms of the medical contribution in Arab world. So that's one. So there is significant proof of being Jats a prominent social group in area of Hijaz. Hijaz, which is now in Saudi Arabia, and earlier it was divided in Hijaz and this Yemen and the other part of nearby this Jordan. So one of the most frequent incidents mentioned in the narration of this era is when Prophet's wife Aisha fell ill. She is reported to have treated by a Jat physician. Jat were not the only tribe who settled in Arabian Peninsula. There were at least more than five groups, namely Miyat, Yabja, Asawira, Bayasira, and Takatira, which is now loosely translated as Thakurs. The Thakurs were also, they had colony in Arabia. Most of this group used to belong to northern and northern western part of India. Qazi Azad Mubarakpuri has talked about them in detail with reference to Arab historians and prophetic tradition. The threats of Islamic missionary during the time of Prophet is recorded by some Arab historians. One of the narratives is one of the Kannauj kings, namely Sarbatak, converting to Islam after his meeting with 10 companions of Islam, Prophet. Some of the companions are believed to be Huzaifa bin Yaman, Osama bin Zayd, Abu Musa bin Ashari, Suhaib and others. A delegation of five companions of the Prophet is reported to have reached Sindh in order to propagate Islam, who succeeded in converting a number of people to Islam. Two of them left to Arab, whereas the remaining three chosen to stay in India preaching Islam. This is to note these narratives are not authenticated by Arab historians and also rejected by authentics by the scholars of Hadith, which we call Ulama al-Rijal. Zainuddin Malebari also narrated a Malayali king's story of converting to Islam in detail that has also been very controversial, and historians have taken side in this. So, in continuation with Prophet days, India's contact with Arab not only developed but strengthened in subsequent years. We don't find any traces of first caliph of Islam, Abu Bakr, with India and Indians. So Abu Bakr has nothing to do with India. The Qazi Azhar Mubarak Puri believes that Indian tribes Jat and Siabja had fought along with Arab tribes against Caliph Abu Bakr in war of apostasy, what we call Radd, Harbur Ridda. Again, the historical proof is lacking in this claim. Second, Prophet Umar bin Khattab expressed his interest about India and Indian tradition. When he was inquired about India, he was told, its river are pearls, its mountain are rubies, its trees are perfumes. In account of Al-Balazari, when Uthman bin Abul Ala was appointed a governor of Bahrain and Oman by Umar bin Khattab, he decided to explore military expedition to different regions of India. He himself went to Thana and sent Hakam to Buruj, which is in Gujarat, and his brother Mughira was given the duty to look after Debal, which is in now Sindh. So Caliph seems to be not happy about this mission and he prevented from going further. And then after the third caliph came in, so the third caliph, Usman bin Affan, appointed Abdullah bin Amir, governor of Iraq, and asked him to depute someone in order to inquire about Indian front. The job was assigned to Hakim bin Habla. When he came back, the report was sent to Usman, in which it was said, India has a scarcity of water, fruits are not good, and bandits are brave. A small number of armies would be defeated and a huge number would die from starvation. Usman dismissed the report, labeling it as poetic, and desisted from the idea of sending any army. When we compare this report with what was said to Umar bin Khattab about India, the report is exactly contrary to what Umar was told. Probably the assigned person by Governor Abdullah might have visited some deserted area, some mountain area, on the basis of which he made his opinion on India and reported back to the Caliph Usman. During the time of Ali, who is fourth Caliph, Haris bin Marra did military operation, had great success. So what we knew about this from this prophet, from this last three caliphs, that they had made some attack on India, or they had some intention about conquering India or occupying India, what we say. So this is not that the Umar Muhammad bin Qasim was the only or the first one who was appointed to conquer India. So this has been the tradition. And I'll explain why this has been the tradition of Arabs to, I mean, attack India, and why they wanted to occupy India. So I will explain in the second part of my talk. So it cannot be ruled out that inquiry about India made during all three caliphs indicate their intention to conquer India, to propagate Islam, expand boundary of Islamic State. Many historians has tried to justify the idea of Caliph's attack on India as a relation to some misdeed done by Indian Raja. However, Arab historians did not make any reference to transgression which have caused them thinking about invading India. The Count of Al-Balazari, who is the prominent historian of this period, also silent on the motive of their inquiry about India. So this indicates that they had no this sort of counter-attack motive on India. Now we come to the second part of the Islamic era, which is called Umayyad Caliphate system, Umayyad dynasty system. And from this era, the actual conquest of Sindh has happened. So Umayyad's period marks the beginning of change in India Indo-Arab relations. Balazari has written about successive Arab invasion in northwestern part of Indian Peninsula. During Umayyad period, these attacks have increased and several commanders were sent to conquer and rule Sindh. In 60-64 AD, first Umayyad Caliph Muawiyah bin Sufyan appointed Abdullah bin Sawwar governor on the Indian front. He said to have conquered Qaghan and gifted Qaghan horse to Caliph, who is Amir Muawiyah. Soon he was assassinated and Sanan bin Samla was appointed, who conquered Makran. During the course of 40 years, many governors came and went back, including Hakim bin Jabla, Abbas bin Diyab, Ziyad bin Mundir, and others. Some had success, whereas others had not so good time in the Sindh. The last to stay as a governor in the region before Muhammad bin Qasim appeared in the scene to change the course of Arabian history in Sindh was Muhammad bin Harun, who was given the reign in 705 AD. And remained with firm control over the whole of Makran and adjacent areas. Now, a sudden and new development occurred when a ship carrying number of Muslim women and widows, along with the gift from Raja of Sarandip to the governor of Iraq, who was Hajjaj bin Yusuf, it was looted on the coast of Debal, and inmates were taken as prisoners. Hajjaj sent his ambassador demanding the punishment to be given to whoever was involved in heinous crime of looting and prisoning the innocent people, and compensation for the losses incurred as a result of the pirated raid. The Raja replied saying he had no control whatsoever on these pirates. This has angered Hajjaj to the extent that he has secured the permission of the Caliph Walid and dispatched many troops prior to sending Muhammad bin Qasim along with added troop of military personnel and logistic support. It can be said that the Hajjaj was very determined to conquer Sindh at any cost and eradicate piracy, besides projecting commercial interest in the area. So when Muhammad bin Qasim was entrusted to conquer Sindh, he was barely 17 years old. He won the approval of Indians by his determination, integrity, and his firm belief in the spirit of religious tolerance. He has the quality of good negotiator as well as the bravery of resolute commander. His victories over the large area of Sindh as well as the other part of the country attributed not only to his military might, but his ability to negotiate and cooperate with the native of the land. He consolidated his position through cooperation and goodwill of local population. According to the church, Nama Muhammad bin Qasim had full faith in Hindus he had entrusted with the post he had earlier. But the fact is that I cannot find any evidence that he has appointed any non-Muslim on any higher post. I mean, whoever were posted on higher post were converted to Islam. And one of the examples that we oftenly cite that the minister of Raja Dahir was also as appointed as a minister in the ministry of Muhammad bin Qasim. But the fact is that he was also converted to Islam on the basis of which he got that post. So overall, I mean, when we see this, the whole scene, how Muhammad bin Qasim has governed the scene is truly Islamic in a sense. In a sense that he had all sorts of military who belonged to a particular religion, which is Islam. And we can make distinction here with Mahmud Ghaznavi and others, not Mahmud Ghaznavi, other Mughals and others, who had military and who had some conquest, who had some quest of territorial expansion. So that's not the case with Muhammad bin Qasim. He came solely with the intention of defeating piracy as well as propagating Islam. And that's why we see a number of Muslim missionaries, Muslim scholars, Islamic scholars came along with him who propagated Islam, who had made numbers in the scene, who succeeded in converting Muslims, converting Hindus into Muslims. So that's the one thing. And there are there is a lot of talk about why Muhammad bin Qasim succeeded and why Sindhians failed to counter this attack from Muhammad bin Qasim. And there are a lot of narratives, and one of the narratives that came in that Buddhists were not ready to express their help, extend their help to fellow Rajas, and they were quite happy to bond with this Muhammad bin Qasim, negotiate with him. But there are other narratives that who said that the Buddhists cannot be held responsible for that act. There are other factors, the Brahmins also there. So their caste angles also comes in. But the matter of the fact is that there is a controversy behind that, who is the responsible behind this defeat. Anyway, suddenly after 3 or 4 years, Muhammad bin Qasim was called back from Sindh. Because of some changes in the caliphate system which was in Damascus, and this was Umayyad, this has the change the whole system in Sindh, though they have remained in Sindh since I probably till the first part of Abbasid era. So but they started losing, I mean, area from area. I mean, there was Mansura, Sultan, Multan, and Kabul, and some other cities. So they started losing after Muhammad bin Qasim left the area. Well, there is a lot of scholars that came to India and in that era, and I will skip those parts and I'll go to this Abbasi period now. So Abbasi dynasty has brought a lot different thing in the whole discourse of Indo-Arab relationship, and the relationship of the conquest that was there in the Umayyad period has somehow changed or remained the same. So the change of caliphate system in Arabic world, which was from Umayyad to Abbasi in 8th century, and the emergence of Abbasi and the realm of affairs has brought a new energy into Arab world in their intellectual and scientific development journey. Abbasi has made Baghdad the capital of caliphate, which brought India closer to the center of Arab empire. So if you see geographically, the center of Umayyad and the center of Abbasi, the center of Umayyad is the Damascus, which is the extremely western part of West Asia, whereas the Abbasis belongs to the eastern part of some sort of eastern parts of West Asia. So this is some, in a way, it's very closer to the Indus part of, or the Sindhian part of India. This period is considered to be the golden period of Islamic world, thanks to the enormous effort put up by the caliph, ministers, and the foundation of a number of institutions of learning and translation and research. This also marked the beginning of triple cultural relation, which lasted for several centuries. There has been cultural and commercial contacts preceding Abbasi's period. However, the cultural contact between India and Arabs reached its zenith in this period. It can be fairly said that a lot of credit goes to Indian in development of Arabic knowledge system. By the mid of 8th century, Sindh and other part of the Punjab had come under the Arabian control and formed the eastern part of the Abbasi Empire. The exchange of knowledge had started during the Umayyad period, but during Abbasi period, it took a long leap and it acquired great significance in Islamic science, as many Arab religious scholars, travelers, missionaries, and merchants settled in Mansura, Dabel, and other part of Sindh and Punjab. The cities of Sindh proved to be center of dissemination of Islamic religious thought, cultural values, philosophy, and Indian have got first-hand knowledge from them. The political boundaries of Arab Sindh did not go beyond Al-Mansura and Dabel in south, Gurajara Paritihara were made immediate neighbor of Arabi Sindh, who did not allow them to extend their boundaries. They were formidable enemy of Arab and they were on regular war with them. Because of the tussle and the continuous rivalry, Arab were unable to get access to the other part of northern and central India, which resulted in almost no direct cultural exchange between Hindus of North Indian Arabs. This is partially the reason why Arab account of India in this period deals with Sindh and Punjab or northern eastern part of India only. This has also been the reason most of the North India could not get first-hand knowledge of Islam, as the entry of Mahmud Ghaznavi in India gave different impression of Islam in all over the world, in all over India in general and North India in particular. Arab relation with India and South was totally, until now I was talking about the India's relation with northern part or northeastern part, northwestern part of India. Now here, the Arab relation with India in South was totally on different basis. And they came in South as a merchant, traveler, and occasionally missionaries. Because the relation was not based on political weight, this relation proved to be the most cordial and friendly. The ruler of Deccan, Rashtrakuta dynasty, received Arab merchant and traveler with a warm heart and gave them full freedom to practice their religion and provided equal opportunity in the market. The Arab writer of that period spoke highly about Deccan kings, and they had great admiration for the hospitality they received and the respect they bestowed upon. Arabs have also settled in different part of South India's merchant community. There are significant population in Kokan, which is in Maharashtra, Malabar, which is in Kerala, and many coastal towns of Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. Gujarat coastal cities have largest number of Arabs. Besides, several part of eastern India, such as Assam and Bengal, were visited by Arab travelers and traders during Abbasid period. On the other side, many Indians took the opportunity to visit several Arab countries during this time for various purposes. Those travelers include scholars, scientists, physicians, and other men of learning. Traffic of Indian trader and merchant was also flowing to Iraq, India, Egypt, Persia, and other parts of Arab world. The exchange of people from both sides has created a space of settlement of one in other's country. We may find Arab settlers in coastal city of India besides Sikh. Likewise, many Arab tribes formed in Arab countries during the time. So, according to Chairman Kiralal Pathi, Chairman Piramal converted to Islam, and he is reported to have met Prophet Muhammad and died on the way back from Makkah. So Arab historians are silent in this regard. We don't find any reference of Arab historians in this regard. Nevertheless, the popular narrative approves this story very strongly, and this story is very popular in Kerala. Some elements of truth in this story cannot be ruled out. This has strengthened the position of Muslim in Malabar and gave them free in propagating Islam with political patronage at that time. It may be easily said that by the time we enter into second half 8th century, the solid foundation of cultural exchange between India and Arab was laid. the main agent from both sides from for the transmission of ideas and the belief and for cultural and linguistic influences. There are a number of known and unknown scholars, traders, missionaries, and other men of learning, along with impartial and outstanding minister and ruler of India and Abbasid Caliphate. Baghdad, the capital of Abbasid Empire, provided great opportunity and scope for the growth of scientific knowledge and research, and provided a free and liberal academic environment for conducting fundamental research in science. Second half of the 8th and 9th century was considered to be most advanced period of Iran, and there is a lot of controversy about whether some foreign word has been found in Quran, but ultimately some philologists have reached to the conclusion that there are certain words which has been in, there are certain foreign words which has found mentioned in Quran, and we have three Indian words in Quran in which of which one is misk, what we call in Arabic misk, and the second is ginger, what we call in zanjabil, and the third one is kafur. So there are three words and has function that has Indian origin and that has found mention in Quran, and there are and the interestingly that all these words came in the context of drinks that would be offered to the one who will find place in paradise. So these words signify the kind of respect Indian origin things have received in the Quran. There are several other words that are said to be of Indian origin, however most philologists don't approve of having those words of Indian origin. So like there is was toba. Toba is similar to some kind of jannat, but there is a controversy. And the other thing is that the two people that have found mention in Quran, one is the which is very controversial, is the mentioning of Buddha. So how Buddha came to the existence in Quranic literature is very new phenomena. In new commentator, new exegetes have talked about Buddha, and that's the in ayat in the verse which says waskur ismail wal yasa wa zulkifl wa kullu min al akhyar. So here zulkifl actually zulkifl means kifl wala, someone who is from kifl, and we have a famous commentator of Quran called Hamidullah, Dr. Hamidullah, and he argued that prophet has been sent to every part of the world, and we have tradition of like 1,24,000 prophet, and being India the oldest country, we cannot approve that not any prophet has been sent to India. So in Zulkifl they have found Buddha, and Kifl they have translated is Kapila, and someone who is from Kapila, which is Buddha. So they have, I mean, come to the conclusion that Buddha is the mention is mentioned in the Quran. The other is being Adam, and Adam has been discussed in detail in Hadith. I will come to that. So the other part of this the whole discussion is the Hadith. So Hadith is a complex subject, but I want to clear one two or two things regarding Hadith. This Hadith is prophetic tradition, but there are some talks about how Hadith should be taken. Like Hadith, we have Hadith in generally we divide Hadith within authentic and authentic, but that's a very sort of easy going interpretation of Hadith. There are many technicalities in Hadith. Right, so Hadith is authentic and non-authentic, but in real terms Hadith is sahih and hasan and da'if. So we have broadly three categories, and in these three categories we have so many categories. So I'm not going to into detail, but I'm for the general explanation I'm saying. So Hadith has found mention Adams in India. So Adam, there are various Hadith in lot of narration that Adam has landed in India, including Bukhari. Bukhari also mentioned Adam being landed in India. So and some says that's in Sri Lanka, and some say this is Dajna, which is translated as a Dakhin. So Adam is believed to be landed in the southern part of India, and the Ghazali also opined that Adam landed in Sarandeep of India on the Buddha's mountain on the eve, while as the eve his wife landed in Jeddah. According to Jarir Tabari, Adam went back to India after performing Hajj. He performed Hajj 40 4 times afterward. However, he always came back to India after completing Hajj. So there is another notion that Adam stayed in India. I mean, most popular belief is that Adam came here and then after he migrated to Jeddah and he lived whole life in Jeddah. But there are other narration that says that Adam have permanently settled in India. He went frequently to Jeddah to perform Hajj, but ultimately he settled in India. So there are various hadiths. I'm not going to read Arabic because I have to read a lot of poetry in Arabic. So I'm skipping those part of hadiths. But I want to mention that there are some other references of India that has come in hadith literature, like the Indian air has been regarded as the best air in the world. So there is a saying of Abu Talib saying that atyabu ruhin fil alf al hind, that the best air on the earth is the air of India. And mind you, this the hadith is authentic, and this is not, they cannot be taken as an authentic hadith. And there are some other hadiths that say that India's that there is a black stone found in Saudi Arabia. When Muslims go to the Hajj, he kisses this black stone. So that black stone also believed to be landed in India, and Adam came with this black stone. So there are other references that has come, something to do with this Jannah things, paradise thing that have found mentioned in hadiths with regards to India. And there are so many hadiths, I'm skipping those part. And I'm now talking about this, one of the most controversial things right now in India and Pakistan, which we call the Ghazwa-e-Hind. So Ghazwa-e-Hind is something is very controversial topic right now in India. So there are two parts of this, this is the whole thing. So whoever talk about this Ghazwa-e-Hind, he talks about the hadith. So when we talk about the hadith, there are two parts of hadith, the hadith main text and the hadith chants. I think Raju sir will tell about this, and he knows about this. So this is chant part and this main text part. So once the chain is fine, so hadith is right, authentic or sahih. When there is problem in chain, the hadith is problematic and we cannot, I mean, take it as evidence. So in this part, in this, we have so many hadiths, I mean, with different contexts, we talk about the Ghazwa-e-Hind. So we cannot dismiss those hadiths as saying that this is an authentic hadith. So certainly there are some hadiths which are authentic. There are some hadiths which are unauthentic. So on a whole, these hadiths are authentic. But the other part is, did Ghazwa-e-Hind has occurred? Did Ghazwa-e-Hind occurred before, or this Ghazwa-e-Hind is going to happen? There are a lot of controversy about. There is a different opinion among the commentator of hadith with regards to that. So the one of the commentary is that the Ghazwa-e-Hind has not happened. It will happen, and that has been taken by Pakistani side, some of the Indian sides. I'm not going to talk about that, but that has been taken as face value. But the most of the commentator of hadith believes that this Ghazwa-e-Hind has occurred, and that's too when Muhammad bin Qasim has occupied or conquered Sindh, and some go to the some extend it to the arrival of Mahmud Ghaznavi and the plunder of Mahmud Ghaznavi to Ghazwa-e-Hind. So the most of the commentators are of the view that Ghazwa-e-Hind has happened, and we don't have any chance to happen Ghazwa-e-Hind in future. And we have, I mean, I have also one suggestion that Ghazwa, when we translate Ghazwa, so in terminology, Ghazwa is that war in which Prophet has participated. And we have hadiths in which Prophet wanted to have participate, in which Prophet wanted to participate in Ghazwa-e-Hind. So, I mean, we cannot take Ghazwa till now. So Ghazwa is something which should be related to Prophet. And since Prophet has gone, we cannot say that Ghazwa will happen in future. So that's the other part. I'm skipping the third part of this presentation, and I'm now going to the main chapter, which is Arabic poetry in India. move it fast, and I mean I have taken so much time. So in India, the title is Singing India, Indian Contemporary Arabic Poetry. 20th century marks the beginning of foreign theme in Arabic poetry. Earlier, Arab poets mostly used to confine themselves to regional themes and issues pertaining to Islamic nation. However, it began to change in late 18th century with uprising against Ottoman Empire and a strong desire to seek independence from Ottoman as well as Western imperialism. This has led to them think beyond Arab geographical boundaries and seek inspiration from the struggle for independence in other part of the world. For Indian were fighting for independence from British Empire with armed struggle, guerrilla warfare technique, and through various non-violent movements such as civil disobedience movement and others. Arab who had long experience with conventional form of armed struggle, they found a unique way in Gandhian style of struggle against colonial power in form of Ahimsa. Arab poets have a lot of admiration for Gandhi's philosophy of struggle and life, which has been reflected in their poetry dedicated to Gandhi on various occasions. The formation of modern state and beginning of new relationship among various states in the fourth and fifth decade of 20th century has opened a new of forming a strong and formidable relationship between India and Arab nation. Arab starting the opening their embassies India and vice versa, which paved the way for many Arab writers to visit India and enjoy its beauty and interact with Indian personalities and got the opportunity to get acquainted with Arab culture, Indian culture. Many Arab poets visited India as representative of their respective countries, whereas others visited on the personal capacity and some got educated in India and had formed good relationship with Indians. Umar Abu Risha, one of the most influential poets of modern Arabic, was Syrian ambassador to India between 1955 to 1958. In the second spell of 1958, he became ambassador of United Arab Republic and remained for 1 year till 1959. He is said to have convinced Pandit Nehru to open Khajuraho for foreign visitors and tourists and artists. Salah Abdus Sabir is another poet, Arab poet, who has stayed in India as press consul of Egyptian embassy in India between 1977 and 1978. Emiratesi poet Shahab Ghanim, also been a student in Indian universities, admirer of Tagore and regular visitor of India. Enormous attention has been given to Indian political personalities of independence movement in contemporary Arabic poetry. That's due to the fact that both geographical entities were fighting for independence and freedom fighter were fighting on various fronts. They had the vision of modern state in post-independence era, which was based on equality, fraternity, respect for human values, regardless of religion, race and caste. In other words, it may be said that Indians were seen by Arabs as a role model for freedom struggle against colonial power, as well as the torchbearer for modern states in terms of how states should be and on what principle it should based its foundation. Apart from Gandhi, who has been utilized by a significant number of Arab poets from various quarters of Arab nations, Jawaharlal Nehru, Muhammad Ali Jauhar, Zakir Hussain, and others were admired for their courage, sacrifice, and vision. Buddhist philosophy also gained tremendous popularity in Arab world and has been widely discussed. Although Buddha was not seen as a godly figure in Arabic poetry, he has got huge respect and admiration from Arab poets for his wisdom. Muhammad Mehdi al-Jawahiri and Nazik Malaika are the two prominent Arab poets who have embedded Buddha in their poetry. Tagore is arguably the most famous poet in Arab world. His approaches and theme selection in his poetries have been translated in Arabic, led many Arab critics, including among Islamic poets, for his message and the theme that have close resemblance with Islamic idea of aesthetic and philosophy of life. Tagore is one of the most translated and read poet in Arab world, especially in literary circle of Arab world. He has got appreciation from Arab poets as they have penned Qasida in his praise on various occasions. The reason behind Tagore getting this kind of popularity in Arab world is attributed to, of course, his poetic mastery and selection of the theme. But the biggest reason, apart from getting Nobel Prize for Literature, is that they found his work translated in English, which was easily rendered in Arabic. That was not the case with someone like Fazlinur Islam, Dinkar, Nagarjuna, and many others. Apart from Tagore, Iqbal has also received Bairav in very high regard. His popularity can be seen in terms of him being an Islamic philosopher poet of international repute. There is no denying the fact that he was one of the greatest poets of 20th century and contributed a lot as far as poetic aesthetic is concerned. His work has been translated and been huge inspiration for Iranian revolutionaries and pan-Islamists in Egypt and other countries. Some medieval Indian kings also were also utilized by Arab poets for various achievements. Akbar is one of those kings who has been praised by Bahraini poet Ibrahim al-Arid. Shah Jahan is also great for has got praise for his achievement, especially the marvelous Taj Mahal. Indian land and wisdom has been held in very high regard in contemporary Arabic poetry. Khalil Mutran also wrote a beautiful poetry on why the name Hind so popular in Arab world, in which he praised India. Indian natural beauty, landscape, flora, fauna has found place in Arabic poetry. Many among Indian beauty, Jammu and Kashmir have been heavily applauded by Arab poets for its beautiful nature, paradise-like feeling that they have experienced while exploring the region. Arabic poetry theme include Indian wisdom, in which India has been celebrated as minaret of knowledge, which is Manaratul of glory, which is Baladul Majd, and the country of beauty, which we call Baladul Jamal. Indian has been applauded for their courage that they have put up in the fight of freedom against colonizer. They have sung the beauty of India in different form of Arabic poetry. Since the second half of 19th century, physical communication gap has eroded, and the visit made by Arab poet became more frequent to Indian land, in which they have come across a lot of Indian monuments, in which they have written some beautiful poems. Taj Mahal and Khajuraho found place, a special place in Arabic poetry for the charms and exemplary beauty these mountains possess. The positive and rosy image of India in contemporary Arabic poetry continued till 80s of 20th century. This could be attributed to India's active support in the freedom struggle of Arab countries and non-aligned position in bipolar world system of the time, in which India, along with other non-partisan countries, opened a door to third front. Jawaharlal Nehru's active role in formation of non-aligned movement alongside Jamal Abdel Nasser of Egyptian President Jamal Abdel Nasser has made India very popular in Egypt and elsewhere in Arab countries. Besides, Indian policy, which was based on social justice and human rights values, made them stand with Palestinian cause against Israeli occupation. The Gandhian clear stand made India hugely popular among Arabs. He advocated Palestinian causes, saying Palestinian belongs to the Arabs in the same sense that England belongs to the English or France to the French. It is wrong and inhuman to impose the Jews on the Arabs. Apart from Gandhi, Indian Congress support to the cause has reflected in the decision of Congress Working Committee held in 1st July 1936, in which the committee sent greeting and full sympathies to Arab in the Palestine in their struggle against British colonizer. And to further express its solidarity with Palestinian people, Congress decided to observe September 26, 1936 as Palestine Day. It could be argued that Indian support for the cause has political basis, considering Congress was looking for garnering support from Muslim in the independence movement. Hence, knowing that the cause is very sensitive to Muslim, they supported it. However, India's support for the cause, even in independent India, does not substantiate the claim, as India foreign policy continues to support Palestinian cause in 21st century as well. Furthermore, India's support to Arab on different front made India hugely popular in Arab world, and India was seen as a model country for those who believe in democratic values and equality regardless of caste, religion and race. Even unfortunate partition of India after the independence from British, eventually the creation of Pakistan, did not deter Arab from having good relations with India, despite Kashmir being a contentious issue in the region. In the mid-80s, things started changing with respect to India's image in Arabic poetry. Several factors contributed to change India's image among Arab poets. It's not that all Arab poets suddenly started writing negatively about India, but a section of Arab poets started dealing with Indian Muslims, Muslim issue in their poetry. The demolition of Babri Masjid sparked huge rage in the Arab world, and this has dented India's secular and democratic image, and the incident, which was seen as a starting point of departure from traditional Polish position. The Kashmir issues, which was put under the carpet for a long time and India has managed successfully to refrain it from coming under the table, has started appearing in Arabic poetry. As India's support for Palestinian cause was the core of its strategy to counter Pakistan in the issue of Kashmir, it worked very well for India until India started showing the sign of slowness and they opened a new chapter in relationship with Israel. This did not go well with Arab world. Thus, Kashmir issue began popping up in Arabic poetry. I will talk about some the last segment of my presentation. I will talk about this some poetry about this Gandhi and some other parts. I mean, I'll have to skip so many things, but I will deal with at least with Mahatma Gandhi on this in this chapter and within Kashmir and other. So Mahatma Gandhi has been most loved Indian personalities in contemporary Arabic poetry. He has been discussed widely in Arabic academia in general and Egyptian and Iraqi circle in particular. Various dimensions of the dynamic personalities has been discussed in Arabic poetry. The astonishing, the best thing is that Gandhi brought various school of thought in Arabic literary circle together. Whereas he is being praised by Islamists like Mahmud Abbas, Mahmud al-Aqad, and Prince of Arabic poetry Ahmed Shawki and Nadim Rafei, Syrian Arabic poet Afifa Hussaini. On the other side, he is also highly admired by liberal Lebanese poet like Wadi Bustani, Ali Salat, Khalid Jarz, Khalil, and others. His admiration goes to the extent when constitution was declared in Egypt in 1923, Mohiuddin Riza has chosen five to be celebrated, and Mahatma Gandhi was one of them. So Gandhi continues to excite Arab people with his message of non-violence, universal humanity, brotherhood, and to never bow down before any aggressor. Arabic poetry was blessed with his personality. For the first time, he took halt in Egypt on the way round table conference in London. Upon hearing his arrival in Egypt, Ahmad Shawki composed a poetry in which he invited Egyptian to receive Mahatma Gandhi with open heart and considered it to be a duty of Egyptian. And Shawki says, Bani Misr irfa'ul ar, irfa'ul ghaz, wa hayyu batl al hind. وأدوا واجبا وقضوا حقوق العلم الفرد أخوكم في المقاسات وعرك الموقف النكد في التضحية الكبرى وفي المطلب والجهد وفي الجرح وفي الدم وفي النفي من المهد وفي الرحلة للحق وفي مرحلة الوف قفوا حيوه عن قرب عن الفلك وعن بعد. So this is the starting point. I'm not going to translate all those things. I'm moving to other part. Shawki devised Egyptian cultural symbols such as the river Nile, Nile pyramid and Karnak temple to greet Gandhi. This symbolizes what Gandhi means to Egyptians at a particular time. And Egyptian Shawki says, Salamun Nil ya Gandhi, hada zahru min indi, wa izlalum min al ihrami wal kanki wal bardi, wa min mashikhat al wadi wa min ashbali al mard, salamun jalib al shat, salamun ghazil al bard. Some of the translation I can say, greeting from Nile, O Gandhi, the flower is from me, pyramids greet you, so is Karnak and Bardi. Egyptian love and admiration for Gandhi, who has many reasons, primarily being the most strong voice in the colonized nation against British. This admiration from him is in this regard appeared in Arabic poetry. His unique way of putting a fight against colonizer and means implied by him in the fight has been remembered fondly in Arabic lit poetry. Nadim Rafei says about Gandhi, خاصم المعتدل الأثيم الجهارة وقضى ناعما على المستبد الحق ضد بالطغاة ولكن لم يجرد سيفا ليدمي ويردي, which is translated as he has fought against vicious aggressor and he routed out the tyrant. He inflicted injuries on the tyrant, but he never took out sword to bleed. Egyptian poet Khalil Jarjis Khalil put it very beautifully when he dedicated his poetry to Mahatma Gandhi on his 100th anniversary in Egypt. While praising his Gandhi, he said, Asha Gandhi lil mabadi wahdaha wahdaha shadaha bil azmi kasarh al watid anqad al ummata mustamirin wa bana istiqlalaha al hurr yasud bil jihad al haqq la bil unf qad haqqaq al amal bil ra'y al yasid mabda' al la unf adha unfahum. There is what that came in this poetry is called jihad. So jihad should not be taken as a jihad of Islamic thing. Jihad means here as a struggle. So if we can translate this, this is like Gandhi lived for his principles. He built it with a strong determination. He freed the nation, which is Ummah, from colonizer and spread absolute freedom with true struggle, which is jihad, not with violence. He achieved as aspiration and with his honest opinion. So we have a lot of poetries on Gandhi. I'm skipping those parts. I mean, there are so various facets of Gandhi that has been looked upon. Gandhi being a leader, Gandhi being an admirer, Gandhi being a hero of non-violence. Gandhi is seen as a prophetic personality. I can quote one share like Ya Rasul Salam haqqaqta hilman bi huda al-aqli la bi quwwati zand wa jami'u al-fi'ati fi mawtin al-hind taruddu al-jamila wuddan bi wuddin wa jami'u ash-shu'ub tahzu i'tizazan bi mazaya tasmu bi sirati fard. So here Gandhi is referred to the peace of Prophet of Peace. So if we can translate it, we can say, O Prophet of Peace, you have achieved the dream with guidance of astuteness, not with the power of might. All group in India respond love with love and friendliness, and the people are proud of the qualities that makes them special individuals. O the messenger of guidance, O hero of India, peace be upon you, O maker of the best necklace. So I have several poets that have talked about Gandhi in prophetic way. And apart from that, we have Buddha also. Buddha has been, I have already mentioned, I'm not going to quote his quote about how Buddha, but the fact is, I have already mentioned Buddha is not seen as a godly figure in Arabic literature, but he has been seen as some saintly figure. He has been seen as someone who preach, who give the message of peace and so on and so forth. Now, Indian wisdom, one of the things that have appeared in modern Arabic poetry, and they have admired, they have a long history of admiration of Indian wisdom in Arabic literature. I have already mentioned, in my previous presentation, that Jahiz was one of the finest Arab literature, the hero of Arabic literature, and he has talked about the Indian wisdom in his book, and he has wrote a book called Fadlul Sudan al-Bidan, which translates the preference of or the superiority of black on whites, and in which what he meant by black is the Arabs and the Indians, especially Indians. And he had a lot of admire and a lot of praise about India. So I'm not going to that. I'm dealing with poetry here. So Khalil Mataran is someone who is talk about the Indian poetry, and there are some other guys like Ibrahim Fall, and who talked about the wisdom of India and the India being the torchbearer in the field of knowledge. And he says, "Wal Hindu darul rasikhin bi ilmihim, fahum ilayhim bil banani yushar." هم طيب زوج الرسول ألفة ثم نعم الإساءة أفاضل أخيار كذلك هم ساغوا لبغداد اسمها من معدن منه النطار يطار. So which translated as India is the land of scholars, fingers are pointed at them when asked about the knowledge. They have cured the wife of prophet and they are the best. Likewise, they have made the Baghdad renowned. We have other poetry in which I'm quoting one of poetry of Fathi Mumtaz, who termed India as a minaret of knowledge, manara of ilm, and he says, "Biladul Hindi lil aliyai sayara bi azmin yantawi fihi al-mawa'u wa masduka fil mahali ghayru khafin wa ismuka fi famid dunya fakhaw." And we have a lot of poetry about this beauty of land. And I'm finally dealing with the controversial aspect of the other aspect of this Arabic poetry that have appeared in modern that is recent phenomena, if I may say so, in Arabic literature. So there on one hand they have talked about this beauty of Kashmir, and one of the admirer of Kashmir's beauty is Nizar Qabbani, who is very famous romantic poet of modern era, and he has devised Kashmir in his poetry. He has talked about the Kashmir's beauty and all. So I'm not going to read those parts. But the other phenomena that have appeared in certain circle, we cannot say that was not there. So Kashmir was also always there in a circle of Arabic poet, like since 60s and 70s, not before 60s. But that was there. But in recent, the emergence of the militancy in Kashmir in 80s and 90s, that have brought the whole narration of this Kashmir struggle, and they have talked about this in relation with this they have combined the struggle of Kashmir with the Palestinian struggle, and that the struggle that was going with Chechen and Bosnia and other Balkan and part of Muslim world. So they have, we have, I have a lot of Arabic poetry that dealt with Kashmir in very Islamic way, and some poetry they have like talk about this Kashmiri jihad and jihad in Kashmir, and they have a lot of admiration about this the people who were, I mean, doing militancy in Kashmir. And I can quote what poetry of this Egyptian Arabic poet Muhammad Siam, who said, "Shaddul abaim alil jihad wasiru hatta taharra kulluha Kashmir. Ya abta ya ahlana tal ihtilal biladina wa tamarradu zidd al aduw wa suru." So here he says about ki, he says about this ki, we should come up and we should we should do jihad, and we should not stop until the Kashmir is freed. And here is Kashmir is some sort of seen as Islamic state which has been occupied by Indian state, what they have said. So if you go through this whole Arabic poetry which has been written with regards to Kashmir, so I mean in terms of region, we can say that that has been written in some certain part of some certain section of Arab poets. And And if we may say so, we can say that it has been written by some person who has more Islamic leaning than this. This is a liberal poet. Like we have talked about the Umar Abirisha, we have talked about Ibrahim Al-Khal, we have talked about some other poet who have not that much Islamic leaning. So it could be also the reason of emergence of this Islamic literature in modern finance, especially after 80s, they have focused upon it. So this is and we have a long list of Arabic poetry about this Kashmir, and I can quote 7-8 poetry. And they have, at one place, they have talked about this, the struggle that have put in by this Kashmiri women. And one of the poets says, with the title Ukhtahu fi Kashmir, oh, my sister is in Kashmir, Ukhtahu Kashmir ramzut tahaddi was sumud. So they are being ukhtahu ya nab al fadila wal ata'a bila hudud ukhtahu qad salat dumu ifa qalbi wal hudud. So they are praising their struggle, their against in Indian state. And the other thing is that have appeared is the issue of Babri Masjid, and we have a long Arabic poetry of Babri Masjid who talk about some sort of Islamic notion, I mean, some sort of Islamic feeling. I mean, we can agree upon that Islamic state, yeah, Islamic pan-Islamic system could not succeed, and especially in the modern term when the nationalism has arises in our Arabian system, like the Makran sir was saying about this, we have so many blocks, and within Gulf system. We have the Iranian, Turkish, and Qatarian bloc, and we have the Saudian, Egyptian, and some other bloc. So there are some blocs, but still, I'll say that those people who has some sort of Islamic leaning have started writing about this, about the issue of Indian Muslims, and they have certainly they have a strong voices in their mass. So we cannot ignore that they are merely a certain section of people who are writing their poetry. And with regards to Arabian system, if some monarch is in favor with us, so we are dealing with Saudi Arabia, we are dealing with UAE, United States of United Arab Emirates, so we had good relationship with them. But we cannot ignore the what the people think in these areas. So if we are having good relation with this monarch, that doesn't mean that we are having good relations with the people of those region. Especially I'm talking about this in the context of Saudi Arabia. I have a poet from Saudi Arabia called Abdurrahman Ashmawi. He said about this Babri Masjid, and he said ki, أما سقوط البابر فحالة معلوفة تجري بها الأقدار هذه شؤون الهند ليس لنا شأن وما للمسلمين خيار. So he is يا ويحكم يا مسلمون ما أزم آذني تهبي بيت مؤذني مؤذني ينهار. So he is some sort of, he is I mean inciting some Muslims to, I mean, that these things are happening to you and still you are silent. He is inciting Muslim Islamic world that these things are happening and still you are, I mean, silent. I mean, they are, and at one point he sort of mixed the Indian struggle or Indian Muslim issues with the issues of Muslim Balkan and Naxa and Somal. And he says, Hazihi al Balkan, yuharraqu sawbuha amadan, wa yuhtaku arruha al ashrar, tabki wa anti tashrabuna sumu'aha, wa hain aani al haqa'iq zaghat al absar, hadha huwa al aqsa yuhawwadu jahratan, wa bu'usatin tatahaddasu al akhbar. So in one phrase, he's talking about the Aqsa is being Judaized. So it means like India is being Hinduanized, what he meant to say. And he saw some sort of Muslim is being suppressed in India in this context of Babri Masjid issue. I have so many other issues, but I have taken so much time in this presentation, and I have left so many things. So I hope I made some sense with this presentation, and thank you all.
Thank you, Adil, for making such a wonderful scholarly. I know Professor Raju is coming into the debate. I mean, most interesting part was the second part in which you have talked about the recent developments and one kind of a break from 1980s onwards, which you think do not go well with the tradition of Arabic take of India. I mean, there were several kind of strains in which we can find one some bit of appreciation for Indian civilization and various other things. Although you have not ignored the Wahhabis, Pan-Islamism and all kind of associations. That's a wonderful presentation. And I must congratulate you for bringing in these very tricky issues. And those issues are going to bring in a lot of debates which had been suppressed. When you were talking, I was thinking of a play written by Balraj Sahni. That was written in 1969, and in which his character, Mahatma Gandhi, says to Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose, they were meeting in paradise, and they are talking about Hindu-Muslim issues, partition and all that. And this was written by Balraj Sahni, 1969. There, Mahatma Gandhi makes a very important observation, that Mahatma Gandhi of the play of Balraj Sahni. That, you know, Arabs were very intelligent people. They had high regards for Indian civilization. And that is why they were not interested in winning India, conquering India. They were interested in Indian knowledge. And they wanted to come to India to know about Indian sciences and all that. This is Mahatma Gandhi. I think that there was a kind of romantic view of the association between various civilizations, and that was part of a kind of nationalist construction of civilizational dialogues and all that. And obviously you have brought in Tagore, Buddha and all kind of people, and also you have brought in political issues, and you have not gone into the making of Pakistan, etc., etc. But there are some certain indications in your presentation that those people were interested in India, and in spite of partition of India, they remained interested in India, and they appreciated many things about India. So that is the point you are making, and you are coming to this point, which I have already underlined. That 1980s onwards, there is a kind of change in which Muslims are invoked, and Muslims are called upon to defend the cause of Muslim Kashmir, or talk about the Islam Hinduization of India and a kind of domination of Kashmir by Hindu Indian state and so on and so forth. I'm sure many questions would be coming, but before that, I would like you to spell out your chapterization scheme, because you know, this is your annual presentation, and you will have to think about the overall frame of your work also. You should also try to know which part you have covered today and what are the remaining parts in your work, so that we can make suggestions, we can raise questions, we can raise our doubts also, but we also have some idea about the areas which you are going to cover in the next period. Before taking up questions, please spell out what are your chapters and how far you have progressed.
Thesis is the monograph is broadly divided into five chapters, in which of which I have presented two chapters. The introduction one, in which I've talked about the Indo-Arab relations and the Islamic literature, and I have skipped this part of Arab standing of India. I mean, that was important, but it's very difficult to leave that one and take the other one. So anyway, the first chapter was this, and then after I dealt with this poetry, India in Arabic poetry, and that is also discussed. And the third chapter, I think one of the most important chapter of this whole monograph is about the travel literature and how Arab Indian has India has been represented, and how they have seen modern Arab traveler India. So that is one. That's the sub chapter, and the fourth chapter will be on this the scattered Arabic literature, like poetry and fiction and dramas and the novels, how Indian characters have reflected in that part of literature. And the fourth, fifth, that is also one of the important part of the monograph, where I will bring the religious angle of the whole Arab way of looking to India. So there is a lot of religious thinking involvement when we talk about India, and when Arab talk about India and how they treated India, and so many controversial things will come up, like when we talk about this kafir and how kafir is defined. So and so many other issues. So how they have seen the caste system, how they are seeing the caste system. So one of the things that I made this, the whole discussion of this introduction had to do with the comparison with this, how they were seeing this, the core, this golden period, so-called Abbasi period, and how they are seeing right now. So some sort of, I wanted to make the comparison, how they were seeing now, or what are the changes that have occurred. So with regards to this poetry, we don't find any poetry Islamic and the Abbasi era with regards to India, barring some praise of Muhammad bin Qasim and all. But with this, in the travel literature, we have a lot of material in this Abbasi period and onwards, and before that, and in modern period. So we can make good comparison in that area. And with regards to the religion, so how the religion are being discussed, how they have discussed religion, like Biruni and others, so how they have taken Hinduism or Hindu religion, and how they are taking now, how whether they have ignored the Buddhism and the Jainism at that part of the time, and whether they are bringing now, and in which shape they are bringing now in those almost neglected religion in the Abbasi period. So that will be also the part of this final chapter. And in which I think last two chapters will be the most crucial with regards to the question I am dealing with this, the question, the research question, the hypothesis that I made with regards to this monograph. So that's the overall picture of this.
Okay, I ask this question because we have to keep in mind that the thing which you have presented is only a tiny part of your big project, and you are bringing history and religion and even contemporary issues in your thesis. And I mean, it's a very ambitious project, I must say. And let us say what your distinguished colleagues are saying and suggesting. So, Professor Raju.
Thank you. I am afraid I'm going to be cut off by the clock. So, hang on. Now, I think that there are two or three things that you neglected. And I don't want to go into the parts about Al-Khwarizmi and about astronomy and mathematics and Sindh-Hind tradition and Brahmagupta and so on. I want to talk about Islam. The critical issue, one critical issue which you neglected is the Ikhwan-us-Safa. And the Ikhwan-us-Safa was very prominent, and that's an example of poetry from the Abbasi period, which is related to the Quran and which had an impact on the religious beliefs of the time. You neglected. And I think that needs to at least come in. Even your thing, I understand, maybe something contemporary, and you are interested more in Wahhabism and in what has happened and what are the reactions and so forth. But I am pointing to that period, that Ikhwan-us-Safa is a very important thing which should find mention, which finds very little mention. Second point, we're talking about Buddhism, which you mentioned several times. And you mentioned Burma. And Burma Kids Feast finds, it is found in Alif Laila and so on. So, and he was, of course, your, this thing, Wazir to Harun al-Rashid. So, when you mention that, it is a point which has been overlooked by almost all, well, I think all Arab scholars. It's a very critical point, which I have been looking into for some time, and I plan to do further. Al-Ghazali. Al-Ghazali is the central to Sunni orthodoxy. And Al-Ghazali's idea, Asharite's idea of atomic time. Al-Ghazali's focus on logic. And Al-Ghazali's focus on instantaneity, which is central to Sunni thought. Allah creates the world afresh at each instant. And he creates a similar world only out of habit, not out of causal necessity, which is a fundamental division between Islam and Christianity. This is also central to Buddhism. Why hasn't anybody noticed it? I've been trying to talk about it for the last 5-10 years. People just don't understand. They don't know Buddhism, they don't know Islam, and they say, what is this guy talking about? You see, the whole idea of instantaneity, which is sometimes called the Buddhist doctrine of flux, is exactly what Al-Ghazali is talking about. The only difference is that Al-Ghazali is talking about creation by Allah, whereas Buddhists are saying your world is being created, you know, conditionally coordinated, praticca samuppada, and so it's conditionally coordinating at every instant and so on. So who does the creation is a somewhat metaphysical point. But that it is happening is central to both things. And it is not the laws of nature, it is not the scientific laws of nature, which are so much a part of Christian theology since Aquinas. And I think that this is a connection which needs to be explored, the idea of discontinuous time, or what I call ontically broken time, which is central to both Sunni Islam and Buddhism, is something which has been completely neglected. Because after all, the Buddhists were very influential in Iran. And the Burmaks that you mentioned, there are so many, there are archaeological references. If you go to Ajanta, Ellora Caves, you'll find the Iranian delegation. And of course, as I mentioned, Ikhwan-us-Safa, after all, Panchatantra went because Iranian delegation came to India and so on and so forth. So I think that these are some silences. I won't talk about it because it's a vast area that you've covered. A lot of discussion can take place, especially about the latest part about Wahhabism and so on. But I will just stop with these two.
Thank you, sir. First of all, you rightly talked about the Ghazali and his Buddhist influence on him.
Hitendra ji, I just have one very quick comment. I just wanted to say, Adil ji, that you very well know that mean, first of all, I want to congratulate you to, you know, trying to steer a middle path between, you know, contrary perceptions and all that. But that's a different matter. It's a very complex, you know, point there, because internally also, if you read Al-Biruni's, you know, Al-Biruni's India, usme bhi, you know, there are contradictory perspectives. On the one hand, the, you know, superiority of Islam is seen. At the same time, there's an almost detached critical understanding of Indian society, you know. And so what I'm trying to say is when we see other encounters, like you see the British colonial encounter, the attitude changes. Once the British have paramountcy, there is respect before they attain hegemony. And after that, there is contempt. So there are these complex things. I don't want to get into these things right now. Yeah, aapko sab suljhana, I'm not getting into it. And similarly with Kashmir, ye wo. In fact, contrary to what you said, I just pointed out, just by chance, the new trend where UAE and others are veering away from Pakistan just now. And as you said, you know, the imam and the state head and the praja are different. So that's all very complex. But I just wanted to say one little thing, that Arabic literature doesn't mean Islamic literature. Just as Urdu literature doesn't mean Muslim literature. A lot of Arabic literature was written by Christians. Lebanon is still 40-50% Christian. And Syria had a large Christian population. Iraq had, and of course, Egypt as well. And these populations are also getting decimated. So overwhelmingly, Arabic literature is going to be identified with Islamic literature. That I understand. But jab aapne, I mean, you have to make that distinction. And there are some major writers. I mean, Edward Said himself was a Christian, though he didn't write much in Arabic. So that was my one comment. Carry on. You have a very complex question to answer from Professor Raju. So I'm going to mute my mic and listen in on that one. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. So first of all, I want to make it very clear that Arab does not mean Muslim only. So sir rightly pointed out that there are Christians, Arab writers, like he has mentioned this Edward Said, who certainly did not write in Arabic, but we have very famous writer Khalil Gibran, who was Christian and wrote in Arabic. We have Khalil Mutran. We have two different school of Arabic, modern Arabic literature. We have a full section of Mahjar literature, and Mahjar literature means those people who migrated from Lebanon to United States of America or the Southern America. They have made their school what we call Madrasatu Diwan, and there is a Madrasatu Apollo. So we have two different schools, and the both schools are dominated by Christians. So we have long tradition of Christian writer in Arabic, and that is still continued. And apart from that, we have a large population in Palestine, Jewish population in Palestine. Apart from that, we have not only Christians, we have Jews Arabic writers. We have very famous name Marun Nakash. Marun Nakash is a very famous writer from Egypt, Algeria. He's Jewish writer. So we have long tradition of this Jewish and Christian writer. We have one more Egyptian writer, and he wrote about Islam. He was a Christian. I'm forgetting his name. Jurji Zadan. Jurji Zadan was Egyptian, and he wrote about the Tarikh al-Tamaddun Islami, history of Islamic civilization. So that's there. And coming to the Saraju's questions, yeah, certainly Ghazali is being ignored with regards to his influence on Buddhism. But there are many others. I mean, if you talk about the Sufi traditions, like you have written about this Ibn Arabi and all. So, I mean, this is a very complex issue, and I will certainly look into it. And with regards to Ikhwan Safa, has he to do anything with this poetry and all, or India? I fail to understand it.
Yeah. Ikhwan al-Safa is a long poem essentially on the Iran, on the Quran. You'll find it, you just download the copy, and why don't you read it? It's a commentary and it's a reinterpretation of the Quran, where you have animals asking, why don't we have rights? And it's a very interesting epistemological question. Of course, Ibn Mugaffa, who changed the ending of the Panchatantra, made it less Machiavellian and made it more moral, he was hanged in the Abbasi regime. So maybe you can also look at that, why he was hanged and what was the great crime of heresy that he committed. But Ibn Safa had come down. But the point you made about the Sufi tradition, it is completely distinct. The Sufi tradition is coming all the way from Egypt, and it has been there for a very long time, and that is a different tradition altogether. It's similar to what happens in India, and that is why the Sufis found such strong resonances in India. So that is a different cup of tea. I'm talking specifically of Buddhism. All right, I'm talking of the Kshanikwad, if you like, and I'm talking about the relation to Al-Ghazali's instantaneity, how he reinterpreted the Quran in those terms. And that has become the dominant Sunni interpretation today. And that connection with Buddhism is missed out completely. The very strong similarity, which needs to be looked at. And the Ikhwan-us-Safa, of course, the whole idea of morality coming from animals and so on, again, something very novel, which needs to be looked at, which has been ignored by a lot of authors.
As far as the Ikhwan-us-Safa is concerned, as far as I know about it, that there were a group of people who came together and who had some visions, some ideas, and on which they have come together. So that's the other part. Around the Panchatantra, Ikhwan-us-Safa. Okay, I'll look into it. I have read this Panchatantra, and I have ignored that part intentionally. That's there. I mean, I have written about it, but yeah, I will look into it. This aspect. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Yeah, Balramji.
Before Balramji takes over, I mean, there is something flashed in my mind when I was listening to Professor Paranjpe and Professor C. K. Raju. You are a researcher of modern Arabic literature, and you are bringing in history of the period about which you need a specialized knowledge also, and also you are bringing religion as very too significantly in your project, because you started with the idea that Arabic thing started with Prophet, and you have brought in Prophet prominently in your discussion. And that is something which will take you to a direction in which Islamic things become very, very prominent in your entire thing, whether you qualify that later on that Christians also become part of that Arabic literature corpus and all that. So there can be one kind of suggestion to make you safe so far as your work is concerned, because you don't have 6, 7, 8 years time to work on it, could be that you take you keep the focus on modern time and look back with secondary sources and do not get too much into those kind of debates which require certain kind of specialized knowledge about it. When you're talking about Ghazali's period is, you know that, and then you have Sufism and Sufism's roots in Egyptian, all that. All these things are quite complicated, and you will not be able to make a kind of general consensus around things which you are actually trying to say through by your reading of modern Arabic literature. So that is where I think you have a point in saying that you cannot go into the entire corpus of literature around that. You can also, I mean, you can have a certain kind of take about as a student of history, because you are bringing history into it the way a historian would like to bring in. That is why I think you are making your job slightly more complex, and because these are very, very specialized things. I was thinking of Satish Sabharwal. He wrote about it, and he found one gutti, one kind of problematic in which he brought in the Persian versus Arabic Islam into it, and then he made certain kind of observations. So one kind of gutti is there, and that gives you something to something to differentiate between two variations of historical past and all that. Yeah, we can go on discussing along those lines. Dr. Balram was making some point. Yeah.
आदिल साहब को सबसे पहले बहुत बधाइयाँ अच्छे प्रेजेंटेशन के लिए. दो चीज़ें, एक प्रश्न है और एक सजेशन है. वो एक तो जो आपने कहा कि गाजी गजवा जो है वो उस युद्ध से संबंधित है या उस धर्म युद्ध से संबंधित है जिसमें पैगंबर प्रत्यक्ष रूप से शामिल हों. लेकिन हम इतिहास के बहुत सारे उदाहरण देखते हैं जिसमें बहुत बाद तक बहुत सारे लोगों ने, मतलब मुस्लिम वर्ल्ड में भी और हिंदुओं के अगेंस्ट भी जिन लोगों ने युद्ध किए इस्लामिक शासकों ने, उन्होंने गजवा कहा उसको और अपने को गाजी का लकब खिताब अपने को उन्होंने दिया. तो यहाँ तक कि महमूद गजनवी और ये जो बहुत सारे जो हैं वो बुतशिकन और गाजी वगैरह उन्होंने लिया. तो ये कैसे बात बनती है कि पैगंबर के बहुत बाद तक जो है वो गाजी, और जो गजवा हिंद का नैरेटिव है वो है भी ये कि इस तरह का धर्म युद्ध किया जाएगा. एक बात ये, और दूसरी चीज़ जो अभी चर्चा चल रही थी क्षणिकवाद के विषय में, तो केवल क्षणिकवाद ही नहीं, विज्ञानवाद जो है बौद्धों का, विज्ञानवाद का तात्पर्य ये है कि हमारा जो कॉन्शियसनेस है वही प्रोजेक्टेड है संसार के रूप में, तो ये भी हम सूफियों में देखते हैं. तो आप अगर इसको देख पाएं कहीं इब्ने अरबी वगैरह में, क्योंकि रूमी तो बहुत ज़्यादा इसको यूज़ करते हैं कि जो संपूर्ण संसार बना हुआ है वो हमारे मस्तिष्क के विचारों का प्रोजेक्शन मात्र है, प्रक्षेपण मात्र है. बाघ हा वो मेवे हा अंदर दिलस्त, जो बाघ दिखाई पड़ रहे हैं बाहर और बाघों में जो फल दिखाई पड़ रहे हैं, मतलब सब कुछ जो कुछ बाहर है वो वस्तुतः हमारे अंदर भी है. तो ये तो मैं फारसी को कोट कर रहा हूँ, लेकिन ये चीज़ जो है वो निश्चित रूप से अरबी सूफी जो हैं उनमें कहीं ना कहीं है. तो और एक इंटरेस्टिंग चीज़ मैं जानना चाह रहा था आपसे कि पैगंबर के विषय में जो शक्कुल कमर की बात आती है, चांद के दो टुकड़े करने की बात आती है कि उन्होंने चांद को दो खंडों में बांट दिया था और ये बहुत बड़ा मुजज़ा था, बड़ा भारी चमत्कार था उनकी ओर से. तो हिंदुस्तान में शायद ये रिवायत है कि यहाँ केरल के एक राजा ने इसको देखा था, तो आपने उसका जिक्र किया है कि नहीं, और उसकी प्रामाणिकता पर विचार किया है या नहीं किया, या ये बहुत ही सामान्य चीज और केवल किंवदंती मान करके उसको छोड़ दिया है. धन्यवाद.
मैं आता हूँ गजबे से. तो सबके लिए आप मुझे अगर बता पाएं कि कौन सा ऐसा जंग है जिसके लिए गजबा का हम इस्तेमाल किए. हमने इस्तेमाल करते हैं गजवाए वहद, गजवाए बदर, गजवाए खंदक एंड ऑल, लेकिन हम जब प्रोफेटिक ट्रेडिशन से बाहर जाते हैं, जैसे एक जंग हुई थी जंग जमल जो अली और माविया वाली,
अली और फातिमा नहीं,
उसको हम लोग हरबुल जमल कहते हैं, उसको जंग गजवतुल जमल कहते हैं. ठीक है, तो अगर आप ऐसा कोई हमारे पास एग्जांपल ले आए जिसमें उन्होंने लिखा हो कि ऐसा गजवाए अंदलुस या गजवाए मिस्र, या ऐसा आपको एग्जांपल हमें दे पाए तो
मुझे बहुत पता नहीं. लेकिन गाजी तो वही है ना जो कि गजवा, जो कि उसके विरुद्ध काफिरों के विरुद्ध युद्ध करता है. तो ये हमें
आता है तो वो टर्मिनोलॉजी आता है, लेकिन गाजी जो है वो गजा से है. गजा मतलब हमला करना. लेकिन कुछ चीज़ें ट्रेडिशन हो जाती हैं, जैसे हम हदीस कहें, हदीस के अगर आप ट्रांसलेट करेंगे तो हदीस माने गुफ्तगु होता है, बातचीत होती है. लेकिन हदीस जब टर्मिनोलॉजी बन गई तो हदीस का मतलब वो जो प्रोफेटिक ट्रेडिशन है, जो बात प्रोफेट ने कही, तो उसमें भी अब वो कैटेगराइजेशन है, वो हदीस मरफू, हदीस मक्तू, एंड वो आपको पता होगा शायद कि वो हदीस जिसके रूट्स जो है प्रॉफिट जाएँ तो वो हदीस मरफू हो जाती है. तो ये तो है, तो वो आप हदीस मिलने जनरल माने वो बात हो जाती है, लेकिन जब हम टर्मिनोलॉजी में कन्वर्ट करते हैं तो वो एक पर्टिकुलर सेंस ले लेता है. तो गजवा में भी यही है कि गजवा का जो रूट है वो गजा से, मतलब जिसके माने हमला करना, तो गाजी मतलब हमला करने वाला, जंग लड़ने वाला. लेकिन जब वो गजवा बन गया तो एक टर्मिनोलॉजी बन गई, उस सेंस में मैं बात कर रहा हूँ. शायद मैं इस पर ज़्यादा देखूँगा और, लेकिन ये है. दूसरी बात शकुल कंवर की बात हाँ आपने की है, और ये एक रिवायत है केरला में कि एक पर्टिकुलर बादशाह था पेरामल या समथिंग जो इस ये को लेकर ये हुआ था, लेकिन मुझे कोई ऐसा कोई स्ट्रांग एविडेंस नहीं मिला। जैनुद्दीन मालीबारी ने इसको जिक्र किया है। तो उस तरह बहुत सारी चीज़ें हैं, जैसे एक एक, एक बात आई कि जब वो सीता को खोजने गए दो युवक, मैं नाम लिखा हूँ, मैं नाम नहीं याद आ रहा मुझे, तो वहाँ गए वो इजिप्शियन उस पर, और वहाँ उन्होंने वो नहीं सॉरी महाभारता में जो दो कैरेक्टर हैं पांडव उनके आपस की बातचीत अरबी की हुई। तो ये तो बड़ी मतलब लिखा है लोगों ने, और इसको मेरे ख्याल में जैनुद्दीन मलिबारी ने लिखा है, और कोट किया सत्य प्रकाश है, मुझे सत्य प्रकाश में नहीं मिल पाया सरस्वती वाले में, लेकिन उन्होंने कोट किया है। लेकिन ये फैक्चुअली सही नहीं हो सकता, क्योंकि अगर आप राम जो महाभारत की जो लड़ाई है तो आप कम से कम तो 3000 साल पहले मानेंगे, या 2000 साल पहले से ज्यादा मानेंगे।
प्रकाश में तो ऐसा कुछ नहीं है,
वो उन्होंने रिफर किया, और एक दो पेपर में मैंने देखा, मैं मुझे भी नहीं मिला, लेकिन उन्होंने रिफर किया। हाँ, लेकिन ये बात लॉजिकली इसलिए नहीं है क्योंकि हमारा जो अरबिक लिटरेचर, अरबी जो लैंग्वेज है, जो हमारा स्टैंडर्ड अरबिक, अरबी में भी आपको पता है कि बहुत सारे वर्जन्स हैं, बहुत सारे डायलेक्ट्स हैं, लेकिन जो स्टैंडर्ड अरबिक है वो कुरैशी अरबिक है। कुरैशी जबान की जो हमको हिस्ट्री है वो 1500 साल ज़्यादा पुरानी मिलती नहीं, तो ये कैसे हो सकता है कि उस ज़माने में अरबी बोली गई, और वो जब क्या कहते हैं वो कौन सी अरबी थी, बहुत सारे डायलेक्ट्स हैं, तो ये बहुत अजीब सी बात है, लेकिन लोगों ने लिखा है इसको। तो इस एक और बात इसमें मैं कहना चाहूँगा कि जो हदीस ट्रेडिशन में, तो हदीस ट्रेडिशन में बहुत सारे ज़ईफ़ हदीस हैं जिसको आप फैब्रिकेटेड भी कह सकते हैं, वीक हदीस भी बहुत सारे हैं, लेकिन जो इंडिया के बारे में वो बात करती हैं कि इंडिया में ऐसा है, या उनकी हवाएं ऐसी हैं, उनके पहाड़ ऐसे हैं, उनकी ये ऐसे है, तो मान लिया वो हदीस ज़ईफ़ है, प्रॉफिट से नहीं आई, लेकिन जिन्होंने उसको कंपाइल किया 8th सेंचुरी में 9th सेंचुरी में, तो उनका इंडिया से जो प्यार है, जो लगाव है, वो कहीं ना कहीं उसमें झलकता है। ये चीज उसको इस तरह से भी हम उसको रीड कर सकते हैं एक दूसरे सेंस में, क्योंकि वो आज की कंपाइल नहीं की गई, वो 8th 9th सेंचुरी में ही कंपाइल की गई। और दूसरी बात ये कि बहुत सारी जो फैब्रिकेटेड जिसको मान लिया गया उनको अलग कैटेगरी में भी कंपाइल किया गया, जिसको हम किताब दुआफा कहते हैं, मतलब सॉरी ज़ईफ नहीं बल्कि उसको फैब्रिकेटेड मौजू अहादिस मौजू करके भी एक अलग कैटेगरी बनी है, जिसको उसमें हम डाल लेते हैं जो फैब्रिकेट हुए हैं, कमज़ोर नहीं है, फैब्रिकेटिंग गढ़े गए। तो वो उस सेक्शन में भी नहीं, उसमें बहुत सारे बड़े स्कॉलर्स, जैसे अहमद बिन हम्बल हदीस के बहुत बड़े स्कॉलर हैं, उन्होंने इन सब चीज़ों का जिक्र किया है, तो आप उनको ऐसे भी रिजेक्ट नहीं कर सकते हैं। मतलब हदीस हो सकता है ऑथेंटिक उतनी नहीं हो, उनमें बहुत सारे कैटेगरीज हैं, मैं उनके डिटेल में नहीं जाना चाहता, लेकिन हाँ ये है। थैंक यू बोलना।
डॉक्टर अंजलि दुहान हैज अ सजेशन एंड अ क्वेश्चन। यस डॉक्टर दुहान, hello, can you hear me, Dr. Dohan?
Yes, sir. Hello.
Ji, boliye jo, Anjali ji.
Am I audible?
Ji, ji.
Thank you. Many congratulations, Adil, for the presentation. It was brilliant. My suggestion is directed not towards the content, but the structure of your monograph. I think it would be better if you would think of moving your chapter 5 after chapter 2, because your chapter 5, the ideas where you're talking about the eye of the Arab or the lens by which you'll be looking at the different genres, it has ideas about religion, kafir, and all those things. So it would be better if you explain that right before you're explaining the genres like drama and religion aspect. So I think that is my personal suggestion, be more structured that way. And question is, did you include information about Jamil Tawarikh? Because it also has information about Buddha and the biography of Buddha and Buddhism. So
Thank you, Anjali ji. The problem with me that I'm primarily dealing with this literature part, Arabic literature part. So I think I will be able to answer those questions that I have raised in my initial thing. But certainly I will look into it and I'm not sure that I will. That's the broad area. I mean, everyone has said about this, and that's too ambitious, rightly. But yeah, I will look into it. But certainly after dealing with this, because we have a time foundation. So if I could, yeah, certainly. And that's the suggestion. And then about Jawami-ut-Tarikh, I don't have any idea about this. And I have. I know about this, but I'm not sure whether it is in Arabic. So if you could explain me whether it is in Arabic or that's available with me.
There are manuscripts. Not the complete manuscript is remaining. Which are left. Some are in Persian and some are in a major portion of it is preserved in the Edinburgh Library.
Okay, thank you. I'll see it and then talk to you about it. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
And thank you, Dr. Anjali. And these kind of suggestions are going to help Adil, because this is annual presentation. It's a very important presentation where we can come up with our critical suggestions, some questions also, and some doubts also, so that the scholar can bring in all those things into the work. Yes, I was looking towards Dr. Subramaniam because he's an expert on it, and I believe that he would bring some good suggestions to you, not only questions, but also suggestions how to give it a focus, a kind of focus in which some good tea or some problematic can emerge from your work. Put on your mic, please.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. So I am no expert on this, and I listened to your talk as a novice, and I really enjoyed the detailed descriptions that you gave. I had a set of comments. I mean, these are more in terms of information. But one question which I had, which probably something which Professor Raju will also be able to throw some light on. When you look at the Arabs translating the works of either Indian civilization or the Greco-Roman civilization, what they take from India is texts on astronomy and mathematics and similar things. And the influence of Indian philosophical thought seems to be not explicitly acknowledged. So there are no translations of Indian philosophical works. Certainly the works on yoga are Amrita Kunda, whatever it is, which had a long life. Stories get translated. But Indian philosophical texts somehow are not translated, unlike the Greek tradition. From the Greek or Roman tradition, they take a lot of philosophical texts for translation and adaptation. So I am quite intrigued by this difference. Why was Indian philosophical thought left out from their thought process? And it was allowed to only come through the way Professor Raju talked about, through indirect influence, which is unacknowledged influence. This is one question which intrigues me. I had a lot of tidbits of information which may be of interest to you. One, the presence of Arabic and Persian traders in South India. They had a guild called Anjuman, which was and in Tamil and the South Indian languages, it becomes Anjuvannam. So if you look at the history of this guild, a lot of people have written on it, you may get some leads into the relation with the Arab world. The other point, about, again relating to South India, a lot of South Indians, South Indian Siddha medicine practitioners and Siddha philosophy practitioners going to the Arab world. You have the famous case of Ramadevar, not to be confused with the Ramdev of North India, of Multan, but Ramadevar, who was a Siddha medicine practitioner, who goes to Makkah Medina, gets converted, becomes Yaqub, and we have texts written by him both as Ramadevar and Yaqub in Tamil. So this is of quite interest that what was he actually doing in the Arab world. Okay, then when you come to the modern period, what intrigues me, I mean, even in the late medieval period, there was a massive output of Islamic scholarship from India, religious scholarship and philosophical scholarship from India, both in terms of study of hadith and other things, and philosophical texts, Sufi texts coming from India. Did the Arabs acknowledge these texts, and did they interact with these texts? This is something which interests me a lot. Was there any religious dialogue between Indian Islam, which was very distinct form of Islam compared to what was developing in the Arab world? Finally, I have one little comment which was pointed out by Romila Thapar in a work on Somnath, that the Islam which came to India from the Arab world and which was found in, say, the Western seaboard, was very distinct from the Islam which came via the Turks into the mainland. And in fact, we have the example of the Arab Islamic settlers in Somnath defending Somnath temple against the Turkish invasion. Interesting dichotomy she points out between two traditions of Islam in India, one which comes from the Arab world and which uses the other Hanafi, am I wrong, school of law, and the Turkish, who probably used the other school, I've forgotten the name. So I think these some details for the medieval period would be of interest to you, if you want to deal with. Actually, I support the suggestion of Dr. Patel that probably you should reduce the pre-modern content of your thing to keep it, you know, workable and easier to handle. It's too large a canvas. I agree with Professor Patel on this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So, as far as the translation of Indian philosophy is concerned, I mean, I think Professor Raju will be more, say, informed person about this, and for the information, this is my introduction part, so I'm not dealing with the each point that I have made in this chapter, first chapter. So that's the first thing. And I mean, probably I'm not sure that the Greek philosophy have reached to them earlier than this philosophy. And again, this when the Indian philosophy reached to them, and there is the whole confluence and of which the Dr. Professor Raju has talked about it. And the presence of the Islamic, the other point is that you have made is the Indian Islam and the Arab Islam. So Islam, there are various school of thoughts in Islam, but we cannot term it as Indian Islam. There are some, they are different in some cultural practices, but we cannot term, I mean, if you say, if I can say so, that this is Indian Islam, this is Arab Islam. There are some schools of within Islam, just like you have mentioned about the fiqh school, like Hanafi school, Shafi school, Hanbali and Maliki, and so on. And there is some other schools have emerged, like Wahhabis. Wahhabis turned out to be Ahle Hadith or Salafis. So there are Salafis in India, there are Hanafis in India. The cultural practice are the thing, and so many other things also add up because of their their stay in India or their constant dialogue with India or their presence in Indian soil. So certainly they will take certain things from Indian religion or Indian tradition. So that's one thing. And the coastal part of the Islam that came from the Turkish area and Islam came from this coastal area. So there's two different nature I have talked about, I think, in this presentation. Those came from this the northern part of area. So the basic thing is that they came as an invader. They came as someone who wanted to expand their area. So that's one thing. And the era of Muhammad bin Qasim, the Arab in the Indini area, has come to an end, I think, in 10th 11th century. So that's other part. With Mahmud Ghaznavi, there were no Arab from northern part of India. And school-wise, they were of Hanafi school. So most of the North India and the still central part of India are Hanafis. And the coastal areas are Shafis because they have come in contact with this the Arabian traders and traders and missionaries. So school-wise, they follow the Shafi school of thought. And recently, probably this Ahle Hadith or Salafi or Wahhabi, whatever we call them. So certainly there is a difference between this dealing with this the attitude of Muslims or the attitude of Muslims that are residing in North India and the people who are residing in South India in their religious practices as well as their behavior as well. So that's a broad topic, you know, if we talk about the behavior. So that's other thing. You have talked about this lot of information. The exchange of that Indian had contributed to this Arab Islamic literature. Yes, there was, and there were so many muhaddis are from this Sindh area and the Gujarat area. So we have long list of people. I have listed them. So yeah, there are long list of, especially in the field of hadith, which we call prophetic tradition. And that's there, and a lot of regional South Indian information, especially Tamilian information with this. Arab land you have mentioned, I will certainly look into it. And my problem is this, that I don't have familiarity with this Malayali or Tamilian language, but certainly I'll get information from you and other guys. Thank you, sir.
Roshanjeet has a question. Yeah.
Can I just add on to what Dr. Subramaniam said? There was some question addressed making reference to me, so let me just finish that off. I hope you can wait, Prasanjit. So I think that this idea that Arabs took a lot from the Greeks is not a valid idea. So for example, when we are referring to Al-Ghazali, who will talk of Arastu. Now, when you're talking of Arastu, this is actually coming from a Syriac Greek tradition, which goes back to the Umayyad times, and where there is a whole lot of translation taking place. You see, when Harun al-Rashid is, Byzantium is a tributary. And therefore, they are translating a whole lot of text taking from Arabic and translating into Greek. And then you have those kinds of Greek texts which are coming in. They are not original Greek. So Aristotle, where is the Aristotelian syllogism found in Greece? It does not exist. And why would he construct a syllogism when they just kill each other and they don't have any tradition of argumentation? There is a tradition of argumentation and debate in India, where you have each school, you know, Jains fighting against Buddhists, fighting against Nyai, fighting against Lokayas, and so on. Everybody fighting meaning not killing each other, debating with each other. So you need a syllogism. And therefore, what you have, what I have opined is that the so-called Aristotelian syllogism is actually the Nyai syllogism, very similar to that. And the logic that he is using is actually a Nyai logic. But somehow or the other, it has gone so far back in the past, and that has never been studied because it's coming from Umayyad times via Syriac and Greek, which are many ways very similar, and that the whole thing gets mixed up. So the huge mythology has been built of what Greeks have done, and this interrelationship has therefore been lost. So that is all that I would like to say. And of course, it's a big topic, but it is not necessarily of concern to you or to your topic just now.
Sir, I am not very familiar with philosophy, but if you look at this Andalusian school of philosophy, especially Ibn Rushd, so how do we reconcile with the idea of this Rushdian philosophy in Muslim tradition? and this with the whole phenomenon of Greek?
It's actually quite simple. You see, Ibn Rushd wrote against Al-Ghazali. You will notice Al-Ghazali had his Tahafut al-Falsafa, and what Ibn Rushd wrote was Tahafut al-Tahafut. And the reason why it was Tahafut al-Tahafut, and the reason why it was picked up by the Christians, crusading Christians, was that they saw the schism in Islam and they started attacking that, because Ibn Rushd is what is used as the tradition, the text of Ibn Rushd. When they talk of Aristotle, Ibn Rushd doesn't use the word Aristotle, he'll talk of philosopher. And those are the texts which are used in Oxford and Cambridge. So when you are looking at Ibn Rushd, and he has really no answer to Al-Ghazali. I mean, he has polemics, but he has not a single proper answer to Al-Ghazali. But that is why it was picked up, because it's a schism that existed within Islam at that particular point of time. And that was exploited by celebrating Ibn Rushd and trying to put down Al-Ghazali, which is happening even today. So I think that what was talked of as the Greek tradition, he was talking of reason. Now, when he talks of reason, it is not the Greek tradition really, it's the so-called Neoplatonic tradition. And that Neoplatonic tradition is going back all the way to Egypt. Why do we call it the Greek tradition? Why not the Egyptian tradition? Why not the Arabic tradition? Why not the Sufi tradition? So, you know, just picking up one point of time and making a big this thing out of it is what the West did. But that is not valid. So it's not really the Greek tradition, it's a tradition of celebrating reason, which goes back to Egyptian times and which persists, which is part of your geometry, Euclidean geometry, and so on and so forth, which is part of that religious tradition. And that is the simple answer to what you are asking about Ibn Rushd. Okay, Ibn Sina is on the other side. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Raju. Then Prasenjit.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the presentation, Dr. Adil. So, so I was just wondering one question I had. So, when about a particular event. So, for example, like for an event like Babri Masjid, right? Or when authors from Arabic, they directly write about that particular event, right? That is one thing. That's how they directly interpret that event through their own, you know, context. And the other thing is when they translate works that have already been written about that event from, say, Hindi to Arabic, right? Even that translation would also, like, you know, sort of be influenced by that particular discursive field, right? Especially in the Arab world, right? Have you seen any sort of patterns, you know, or difference in patterns that may emerge, right? When an event is directly written about in one particular language, or when that particular event is translated into Arabic, right? I mean, I hope I'm making myself clear. You know, is there something that comes out, you know, about this process of translation itself when we talk about how that event is represented in that particular language? Yeah.
So poets' take on any particular issue is very much influenced by the news that he is getting. So is in this context of this Babri Masjid, a lot of coverage has been done in Arab media, and from which they have, and that's a parallel system that is going on from Pakistan. So that a lot of information has been directed to this nation from this Pakistan, and within India, I mean, certain sections were not happy, and a big number of sections were not happy with this, I mean, including Hindus and others. So the information that they have gathered about this, the whole incident, and the background of this, the whole issue. So influenced by these, the whole incident, they have written the poetry. I mean, I don't see any issue of the translation. Probably I could not understand what you were saying, but yeah, I mean, this was the motive of, I mean, writing poetry.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Maybe I'll just make myself more clear once,
Would Dr. Al-Khatyaghi like to come in? Yeah. Dr. Al-Khatyaghi, would you like to come in? Can you hear me, Dr. Tyagi? Dr. Alka Tyagi, I saw your hand raised. I mean, that's why I ask you. Would you like to come in? Probably she's not able to hear me. And I don't think. Oh, Dr. Kamai has a question. Yeah, please go ahead, Kamai. Put on your mic, please.
Yeah, Adil, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Thank you for the enriching presentation you have made. I have two questions. The first question is, how are the tribal people of India represented in the Arabic literature? What is the term, or what are the terms used to identify the tribal people in Arabic literature? The second question is, how are the people and the places beyond the Bengal region represented, if they are represented, in the Arabic literature?
Thank you, Samson. First of all, the Arab context with the whole India is divided into two parts. The first contact that came is through Sindh, and the second contact came through the coastal area of India, in which the Thana and this Bharuch, Gujarat, and this Malabar and the Tamils, or probably Bengals. So the tribal area of Northeast, I don't think they have made any contact with them. Yeah, certainly the modern writers, they have made contact with them. They have written about them. I will deal with this in chapter two. But about the identifying of tribe in Arabic literature. So Arabic literature does not distinguish between the caste and the tribe. So they have, I mean, interchangeable things like tabaqat. The tabaqat sometimes is translated as a race, sometimes is translated as a caste. And there are some other word I forgot. I mean, I have written it. So they don't have this particular word. I mean, generally they do define the tribe like kabila. Kabila is loose translation, but they don't define the tribal system of Arab is very different from the tribal system of India. So Arabi is basically a tribal system, especially the Saudi Arabia, what they call the Qabail system. So I don't see any representation that they have described Jat as a Kabila. They consider everyone to be a Kabila. So they describe Jat as a Kabila, where in India we don't describe Jat as a tribe, right? If I understand it correctly. The second thing in this, as I told you that we don't find any mention about in pre-modern period of any Indian Arabs mentioning of this the whole Northeast area. So probably they were confined to this northern part of India and this southern part, coastal part of India. Thank you.
That's not right. If you look at the Arab sailors, particularly if you look at the not just the Maplas, the people in Andaman, Nicobar, the people in Lakshadweep Island. So Lakshadweep Islanders Maldiv. Used to sail. Yes, Maldiv and Lakshadweep. So they used to sail to Rangoon. The typical trajectory would have been to go to Andamans and then go to Rangoon. Kolkata, Rangoon and Singapore. Right, so they were, once you go to Rangoon, you can't really say you are cut off from the Northeast, right? That won't do
Rangoon
because
it's a very big part of this, the whole Burma and I mean, if you see this broader India context, yeah, that's there. But if you, particularly this Northeastern, that we have existing Northeastern, I don't think that they have made into Tripura or Manipur or Meghalaya or Arunachal.
Yes,
they were not divided like that, but they were getting in there and they were trading there extensively.
Yeah, Rangoon, you are right. You have mentioned this Andaman.
You are required here now. I mean, please come in.
No, I was more interested in some contemporary issues, particularly how does the Arabic literature, whether it is poetry or prose, depict India's economic development and models of economic development? Is that an issue at all, particularly since the Arab models of development, particularly in the colonial world like Egypt, would have been very similar to India, and the initial trajectory of modernization with the Russian help, etc., the patterns were very similar. I wonder how the Arab scholars, particularly those looking at the economic and developmental questions, do they at all appear interested in India's economic development and the path of development?
Sir, as far as the economic is concerned, that's their part. I mean, that's economists to decide. And the poets are more interested in the aesthetic part of anything, any country, any people, any place. So I don't think they have addressed this economic issue in this the whole Arabic poetry, whether it's modern or.
Al-Biruni talks of the similarity in the economic development between India and Greeks. And he says that in both the countries, the poor are, really badly treated. And he draws a parallel between these two. It is in Kitab al-Hind. Whether you consider that, you consider Al-Biruni part of the literature that you covered. So I thought I should mention that. But I think Dr. Subramaniam's question is about the current economic development, which I don't know about.
Yeah, Al-Biruni is himself is a school. So he needs a separate study on that.
Try to understand what I had said, and that was supported by Dr. Subbu, that these are quite complicated issues. You know, on the one hand, you are saying that poets are more interested in aesthetics and not in economics. On the other hand, these poets you are referring to, they are very interested in Babri Masjid and Kashmir and all that. So these are quite complicated issues. So I'm saying it in a lighter vein. I think I would like to give you a suggestion that, you know, these complicated issues need to be given due attention through the experts of those fields. And that is, I strongly believe that for a scholar of your age, it would be a project which you can handle in the given time. So you will have to make a choice. You can obviously go into the past and bring in those kind of what is called imagination as well as a memory, which a particular kind of literary tradition can give you. But you will have to make a choice. And that is where there would be some questions like, what are the sources of information about India for modern Arabic poets? You know, there are certain the traditional understanding of a country or civilization called India, that is there, and that those things are there. But what are the sources? How you come to a conclusion as a scholar when you say that dealing with the king is one thing or ruler is one thing and people's sentiments are different? You have made that statement, and that's a very important observation. And so many other things you have mentioned. So you will have to be very careful about the approach. What is your approach? How literary sources tell us about the Arabic perception of India in the modern times? That is one way of looking at it. And obviously you can bring in history into it. But anyway, these are the things which we can go on discussing. And I'm really delighted that an appeal I had made in earlier presentation that we should not stop at 2 o'clock, 2 hours duration. We should go beyond that so that we can have more. Please, Subhuji, if you want to add something.
Abhishekji also wanted to ask a question, but before that, I just had a curiosity from the aesthetic point of view. There is a...
अब तो बहुत कम उम्मीद है कि कोई और इसको ज्वाइन करेगा, लेकिन आदिल सुनाई दे रहा है आपको?
ठीक है.
बहुत शुभकामनाएं आपको, तो बहुत अच्छा आपने बहुत अच्छे से प्रेजेंट किया। दो मेरी जिज्ञासाएं हैं, दो बल्कि तीन छोटी छोटी जिज्ञासाएं हैं। इस विषय पे बहुत चीजें नहीं जानता मैं, तो इसलिए एक तो ये कि भारत विभाजन को लेके अरबी साहित्य में जो लिखा है वो किस तरह का है, थोड़ा सा वो बताइए, अगर थोड़ा थोड़ा बता सके। और एक चीज तो आप जानते होंगे वो ये कि पिछले 10-11 सालों में जो भारत रहा है अभी, इसको लेके क्या कुछ नए लोग लिख रहे हैं क्या, जो अभी 10-15 साल का भारत है, हालिया भारत, इसके बारे में अरबी लेखकों ने कुछ लिखा है क्या? और तीसरा, जिस पे हम लोग एक आध बार बात भी करते रहे हैं, कि जाति को उन्होंने बहुत रोचक तरीके से देखा है। किसी ने कहा 4 हिस्से हैं, किसी ने कहा 7 मैंने वर्ग हैं, तो वो थोड़ा सा अगर आप बता पाएं, क्योंकि तो ऐसी उलझी हुई समस्या है जिसको यहीं रहने वाला आदमी नहीं ढंग से समझ पाता है, बेचारे उन्होंने कैसे देखा है, थोड़ा वो जानने की बात होगी।
शुक्रिया अभिषेक जी। फर्स्ट पार्टीशन की बात जहाँ तक है, तो पार्टीशन का जो मैं अभी हिस्सा देख रहा हूँ, तो ऐसे बात है, पार्टीशन न्यू फिनोमेना है। तो सर्टेनली पोएट्री में ऐसा कोई एलिमेंट नज़र नहीं आया जिसमें वो पार्टीशन की बात की हो, उनके प्रेस ने कवर किया है जर्नलिज्म में, लेकिन पोएट्री लिटरेचर में अभी तक पोएट्री में एटलीस्ट रिफ्लेक्ट नहीं है। हो सकता है मैं अभी इस पर डील कर रहा हूँ, क्या कहते हैं, नावल एंड ड्रामा पे, तो शायद उसमें शायद मिल जाए, लेकिन पोएट्री में ऐसा कोई एलिमेंट नहीं मिला है। एंड इंडिया के बारे में कवरेज जो है वो पिछले 15-16 सालों में काफ़ी ज़्यादा बढ़ गई, ये बात सही है। काफ़ी अरबी क्या कहते हैं प्रिंट मैगजीन ने, इंक्लूडिंग इलेक्ट्रॉनिक चैनल्स काफ़ी कवर कर रहे हैं। अल जजीरा इस मामले में काफ़ी पार्टिकुलरली इंटरेस्ट है। अल जजीरा ने आपको, अगर आप पता होगा, तो उन्होंने काफ़ी सारे इंडिया दलित पे किए हैं, हिंदू दलित प्लस मुस्लिम दलित, मतलब वो दलित जो मुस्लिम कन्वर्ट हो गए हैं उन पर उनकी कई सारी डॉक्यूमेंट्री है। तो उनके उन्होंने इंडिया से काफ़ी सारे इश्यूज़ को, मतलब जो हम ये नहीं सोच सकते कि इंडिया के अलावा कोई लोग उसको कवर करेगा, उनके काफ़ी सारे जर्नलिस्ट हैं और, तो वो कवर करते हैं। और ये जो है सोशल मीडिया में भी इस चीज़ों काफ़ी कवरेज है, और उसके मेरे ख्याल में अभी जो एक लास्ट कंट्रोवर्सी हुई थी, जो फिर किंग कासमी फैमिली जो है वहाँ, एक शारजा की रूलिंग फैमिली, उसमें से किसी ने कुछ सवाल उठाया था जो इंडियन ट्रेडिशन को लेकर, मुस्लिम उसको लेकर, तो वो चीज़ें तो जाहिर सी बात तो बच रही हैं। और जहाँ तक कास्ट सिस्टम का सवाल है, तो कास्ट सिस्टम हम जब वो एंशियंट इंडिया सॉरी 8th-9th सेंचुरी में के जो अरबी राइटिंग, उसमें कास्ट सिस्टम डील किया है, और सर्टनली अल बैरूनी ने उसको ज़्यादा डिटेल में ये किया है, क्योंकि अल बैरूनी यहाँ रहे, उन्होंने पढ़ा। तो अल बैरूनी के बारे में वन ऑफ द क्रिटिसिज्म ये है कि अल बैरूनी ने किताबों से ज़्यादा इस्तेफादा किया, किताबों से ज़्यादा लिखा, लोगों से कम मिले। लेकिन एक दूसरा अकाउंट कास्ट सिस्टम में ये है, जिसमें हम कास्ट सिस्टम को 6 हिस्सों में बांटा जाता है, जिसमें एक शाक्रिया अरबी में इसको कहते हैं, अब उर्दू में पता नहीं कैसा है, हिंदी में ट्रांसलेट करेंगे, तो वो एक डोमिनेंट कास्ट होता है, फिर सबसे नंबर एक पे है, उसके बाद ब्राह्मण क्षत्रिय वैश्य, ये 4 हैं। उसके बाद दो और कैटेगरी बनती है, चंडाला एंड डोम्स, तो ये 7 कैटेगरी वो लिखते हैं। लेकिन और उनमें कई सारे लोग हैं, इदरीसी है और इब्न खरदाज़बा बोल के एक स्कॉलर हैं, जिन्होंने कास्ट सिस्टम पे लिखा है। तो ये लिखा है, लेकिन इसमें क्रिटिसिज्म ये आता है कि जो सारे अकाउंट्स हैं वो मिलते जुलते हैं, 7-8-7 इसी तरह लिखा है, और बाय एंड लार्ज वही वो है। तो इन पे ये क्रिटिसिज्म बनता है कि जो कास्ट सिस्टम को उन लोगों ने डिफाइन किया है वो एक रिपोर्ट पे बेस्ड है, जिसपे जो अब्बासी दौर में एक वजीर हुआ करते थे, जिसका मैंने जिक्र किया, खालिद बिन यहया अलबरमकी, फरामेका फैमिली हुआ करते थे, तो उन्होंने एक डेलीगेशन इंडिया भेजा था इंडिया सिस्टम को स्टडी करने के लिए। तो उन्होंने भी यही कास्ट सिस्टम, जो ये 7 कैटेगरीज है, उसी को लिखा है, और बाकी लोगों ने भी घुमा फिरा के मिला जुला के वो सेम बात की ऑलमोस्ट। तो ये कास्ट सिस्टम का ये हिसाब है। मॉडर्न सिस्टम में भी मैं पढ़ रहा हूँ, तो वो मैं लिखूँगा सब्सिक्वेंट चैप्टर में, कास्ट सिस्टम कैसे अभी के लोग बैठते हैं। माइक बंद है सर आपका।
आई डोंट थिंक अभी कोई क्वेश्चन और है, और आई थॉट दैट सुबोध वुड कम इन, बट I don't think he would be coming because perhaps
बाहर मिल जाएंगे.
हाँ, yeah, the discussion will go on, and I must congratulate Dr. Adil for making not only a great presentation but also he fielded the questions very well. And in fact, many things which were not very clear to us during the presentation became clearer when we listened him during the question answer session. And I think many things we learned. We hardly know anything about that region and its literature and its association. Now we, thanks to Adil, know a little bit of it, and also acknowledge that this is a very, very complex subject. And I repeat that one kind of a choice is to be made to make it more viable and manageable project, and that will leave, that will give you something which you can actually bring in even within that limited space. It's not that always you have to deal with the entire past to make a statement or make a scholarly contribution. It is quite possible that you are deal with 50 years time and then you bring in the entire historical evolution and all that into it. But things are to be made manageable, and I believe that you will be able to do that. And I am quite hopeful that you will think about it, and all the suggestions which came from different angles. And Prasenjit has raised a question which probably it was not answered adequately. I believe that he's raising the question of translation, and it's this is what you said probably. And so you friends will continue the discussion. At this point, I feel really privileged and honored to chair this session and learn in the process. Thank you very much, Adil, and thank you all fellows for being with us for a long time. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.